Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome back to the channel. I hope you're all good and well. We're in Nairobi today. Wonderful Kenya. On Microsoft Flight Simulator for a little Kenya Airways flight out of Nairobi International Airport here down to Livingstone in Zambia. A new payware scenery released recently by a new scenery developer, 61 Tree Studios. Nairobi is freeware, so both of the sceneries that we're at today are in the description down below. So if you do want to download either, Livingstone's a payware airport, Nairobi here is a freeware airport, and we're flying a real world Kenya Airways route across to Zambia today on the VATSIM network. Welcome Ian, good evening. Rab as well, good afternoon to Ian. Justin, welcome. Dwal, welcome, welcome. Oh, I'm shocked. Welcome to you tuning in at the right time. And Badger, good afternoon. Everyone else in the live chat, welcome on board. Hit like and subscribe if you are new to the channel. And don't forget to say hello in the live chat as well. I've actually been here quite a few times in the past. Fairly familiar with it. Having operated in and out of Nairobi with British Airways years ago when I was working as crew. Always an interesting experience. Not BNXO, welcome. Carlito, how hope you're well, and good evening to you, Doc. So it's actually quite a nice little freeware scenery. It does require one of the sim updates, I can't remember which, to make it good. But yeah, otherwise a very nice bit of freeware, isn't it? And dare I say, there are payware airports that are a lot worse than this. A couple of folks, there's one in the Dreamliner just passing over the top of, on the heavy stands. These are the stands, by the way, when I was working at BA as crew, these two stands here were the ones that BA usually parked the 777s at. We pushed, started, and then we had a very short taxi to 06 more often than not. Incredibly well floodlit apron area this, and stowaways were a risk. So what happened quite frequently is we would push start, get everything ready, we'd start the safety demonstration really quick, get it all done, so we have a continuous taxi from these stands here out on the taxiway, ding the bells, get clearance, line up, lights are on, and then keep rolling on the line up and then away back to Heathrow. And that's how it used to be when I was flying in and out of Nairobi before. Some of the other airports, like Lagos, Abuja, Accra, very similar as well. But yeah, it's pretty nice, isn't it, this, for a freeware scenery? Lots of little bits of detail and stuff dotted around the terminal areas, but otherwise, actually really quite nice. I'm just going to try and get a nice screenshot there with everybody in. There we go. Tracking the flight on Volanta, and we've got New Sky, our virtual airline client, powered up as well for our little flight today. And there we are, stand 16. There's no GSX profile for this, by the way, so we will have to see what happens when we do push back out of this weird kinky line. We're probably going to push back with the nose pointing that way to then taxi off around that little junction there. It's more than likely what we're going to be doing today. But boarding is in progress. We've got half the punters on board. Bags are being thrown in as we speak. And we'll just go through some of our pre-flight stuff in a moment. This livery as well is on flightsim.to, created by our very own Demo Designs, who's made a number of our virtual airline liveries for Osprey Airways. He's made this very nice Kenya Airways livery, I might add. And if we just go into the flight deck, into the cockpit, I should say. This one's a generic PMDG flight cabin area. Let's get rid of that. A lot of the pre-flight's done. I'm going to change the wheel to 782. So I've got an immediate reference. For our flight number, and there's our speeds for today. So if I just show you guys the charts, quickly pop us on to Unicom. So this is what we've got today for our little routing. Heading out south over Kenya into Tanzanian airspace, this beautiful bit here And then heading off into Zambia. At the very bottom end of Zambia, we'll find Livingstone, which is just down here near this beautiful river. I can't remember the name of. It's near to Lake Victoria, I think, from memory. Stony 1 Delta departure out of runway 06 here at Nairobi. So initially flying runway heading to at or above 6,300 feet, then turning south to the Stony VOR 1155 between 8 and flight level 100. And then an outbound radial of 208 degrees for 111 miles out to our transition of Losin before we head off en route. Cruise for today, flight level 360. And the cost index is 30. Airport elevation, 5,330 feet. And this is one of those things, actually, that Boeing is quite good at. Hot and high, isn't it? It's known as. I think Airbus have always kind of struggled. At least the older Airbus have struggled. Not sure about the newer ones. They're probably okay. But it was a thing that the 757-200 was particularly famous for. Its ability to perform very well in hot and high conditions, which is why it was so popular. Matthew, hello, welcome. Yeah, quite high altitude. So basically, we're going to get to about 1,000 foot above ground level before turning south. So it could be quite a good one. Long runway, 3,747 meters for the takeoff roll. And that's it. Charts. We've got the Luke Air tool, lukeairtool.net, for those freeware cabin announcements. So as I'm just going to click through some of the little bits in the FMS and change the pressure panel, I'm going to play the welcome aboard announcement for Kenya Airways via the Luke Air tool.
Ladies and gentlemen, for the flight deck, your captain, a very warm welcome onto this flight. We are in our final preparation and as well waiting for our exit clearance, and we should be on our way. At this time, please make yourselves comfortable and especially pay attention to the crew. We'll be pointing out the safety features aboard the aircraft. We have an excellent team taking care of your safety and comfort, and they are led by flight passer Samuel Manga.
5350, that's as close as we can get.
Welcome again aboard Kenya's flight. Safety regulation requires us to remove certain safety features on board our aircraft. We are going to be screening a video, please pay attention, even if you're ready to touch the video.
That's all good. And APU. Start. Afternoon, Rob. Hope you're well. It's got VOR 1, VOR 2, FCP set to 10,000, runway heading 053, and V2 plus 10 of 160 knots. The outbound course outside of Stony is 208, and runway heading is set to 053 based on the NavX VOR 1131. And I've got them both tuned in. So Nav 1 is Stony, Nav 2 is the NavX VOR here at Jomo Kenyatta International Airport at Nairobi. Power brakes are on, transponder set to 2000. And let's have a quick look here. So, 70.3 tons, cruise to 360. There are cruise winds, the average 086 at 12, and the climb out transition of 9,000 feet. With the performance for today, should probably turn our attention to this actually. There we go, just re-import the weather and recalculate that. So runway 06, elevation 5331 feet, runway heading 53 and no slope. We're going for flap 5 and toga with a sail temp of 32. Trim 582, and there are speeds there that match what we've got in the box as well. We've got no weather data for Livingstone. So what we're going to have to do is have a little look at our nearest alternate, which is FVJN in Zimbabwe, I think. Let me just double check. I'll have to find our next nearest airport. It's a complete different country. But maybe some of you guys can help while we're en route, work out weather and things for en route, because we don't have any weather at all in Livingstone at the minute. But yeah, 32 degrees for the sail temp, takeoff toga 26k, and then revert to climb profile 2 for that smoother climb out. And then flat 5, and that's all set as well. So, jolly good. Ah, we've got ATIS. Henry, thanks to the ATC, 1187. What else have we got? Let's see. So, ATIS information, Bravo. QNH1018. Nairobi Tower, good afternoon. Kenya 782, Boeing 737-800, stand 16, QNH1018 with Bravo. Request clearance to Livingstone, please.
Kenya 782, Nairobi Tower, hello. You're clear to Livingstone. Stony 1 Delta departure, Lawson transition. Runway 06, initial flight level 180, squawk 1337.
Cleared Livingstone, Stony 1 Delta departure, runway 06, Losin transition, initial climb flight level 180, squawk 1337, Kenya 782.
Kenya 782, refresh direct, QNH 1018, and post ready for process back.
Okay.
Kenya Tower, g'day, Kenya
Qantas
86, gate Juliet 17.
Someone keeps Airbus flying in Australia too much. So, initial climb flight level 180.
With information alpha.
So we'll set that.
Kenya
break RTO.
8656, Narita, hello.
Is that the nearest you option available ramp for Livingston?
Stony 1 Delta departure.
Center tanks, oh, we've got fuel in those.
Runway 06, initial flight level 180, squawk 1346.
Pop all the pumps on. Pumps, probes, hydraulics.
Cleared as filed, departure runway 06, Stony 1 Delta departure.
Happy bleed.
QNH 1018.
GSX, prepare for pushback and departure. Release ground power.
Kenya,
oh, it's a new feature.
Kenya 8656, refresh correct. QNH 1018,
oh, look, disconnecting.
Full advise, ready for push. Kenya 8656.
We'll get rid of those.
Hello, Captain. We are ready for pushback.
I love local, local announcements and things. On flight sit on this.
Nairobi Tower, very good afternoon. Osprey 2472, type Boeing 737, stand 19 with information Bravo on board, requesting IFO to Livingston today, please.
Because I saw the jetty go.
2472, Nairobi Tower, hello. You're clear to Livingston.
Cool, that's closed.
Stony 1 Delta departure, Lawson transition, runway 06. Initial flight level 180, squawk 1345.
Clear to Livingston via the Stony 1 Delta departure with the Lawson transition for runway 06. Initial altitude flight level 180.
Rightio. First time flying in Kenya, I think, actually, for the channel. I'm excited for this. And Kenya Airways. Now, we've got no custom pushback here, so I've got no idea how this is going to work.
QNH 1018, and we'll report when ready for push and start. Osprey 2472.
Nairobi Tower, Kenya 782, stand 16, fully ready for push and start.
Kenya 782, stand Gulf 16, push and start approved, face north.
Push start approved, face north, Kenya 782. So, nose left, tail right.
Tail, good afternoon.
I think.
With information alpha,
it's either that or I've just got that the wrong way. Because you become reliant on very good quality custom pushback stuff. So when you don't have them, then, yeah, my goodness. You're like, whoa, what's going on? Which way do I need to go? Rightio, so engine start, ignition ground for two.
Losan transition, runway 06. Initial climb to flight level 180.
I have no idea where we're going.
0556, Osprey 27 Alpha.
This is a default GSX profile. Engine 2 starts. Philip says, finally, earlier on today, before the stream started, Philippe said, finally, a Zambia scenery.
Ready for push and start.
Oh, we're going this way now.
Kenya
8656,
time for push, you're on number one.
As long as we're facing the right way, I don't care. Okay, let's start the safety demonstration.
This short film highlights important.
Hopefully you can hear it. Let me know if you can't.
So may we please have your attention. If you haven't already placed your bags in the overhead locker, you should place them under the seat in front of you. Bags must not be placed in the aisles or next to an exit. Please be careful if you open an overhead locker, as a bag may fall out and hurt someone. You'll need to fasten your seatbelt for takeoff. To fasten it, push
LukeAirtool.net Aurora.
Like this, and adjust to fit.
We're going to stop soon, open, hopefully we do.
Lift the buckle, like this. If you're travelling with an infant on your lap, we have special...
Tug's decelerating.
And Nairobi Tower, Osprey 2472, is ready for push and start, stand 19.
Bloody ripper, that's worked well nicely.
Osprey 2472, stand golf 19, push and start approved.
Push and start approved, Osprey 2472.
Please set parking brakes to avoid being woken by crew performing their safety checks. In the unlikely event...
Tower Osprey 2 ready for push stop.
Engine 1-2 bleeds are on, reset fans are on, automatic, APU's disconnected, engines, generators have got the power, APU off.
Osprey 2-0,
thanks. Place the mask on over your nose and mouth. Auto brake RTO, flap 5 selected. And on the system page, we're going to go fully right on the sticks. Back to neutral. All the way left. Neutral. Elevators. And rudders. See how it instantly shot across fully right then. So we'll do a couple of little full deflections again to wake it up. Flaps 5 in green. Engines are stable and good. Clear the bottom screen. All the comms and stuff are set, FCP set. Ah, flight directors. Oh, no. V-nav. Auto thrust. Taxi lights. Probeats. Icing's not required. There's the ground pin. Kenya 782, request taxi.
Kenya 782, stand by. I got an aircraft on pushing back on gate 14.
Roger, hold position, Kenya 782. Just giving us a wave. Kenya H1018, because that's what we were given by a controller, so just quickly change that down there. Trim 583. About that. Salt Sim, Airbus or Boeing? To fly as a passenger, Airbus. Although I do like the Boeing 777. Only because it's taken me on some great holidays in the past. But otherwise, for flight sim, always Boeing, because it's just a lot more immersive, a lot more enjoyable, there's a lot more depth to it, and a lot more work to do. Watching the EGT stabilise there.
Yes, I can hold Osprey 2-0.
Taxi Juliet Golf Kilo Hold Short 06, Kenya 782. Brakes.
Kenya 8656 after the
wee bit of power.
77 taxi through from left.
The design look, Adrian, the A350 is just a whole another level, isn't it? So
737 behind, cleared for push and start, and facing north, Kenya 8656.
Osprey 27 Alpha, after the Kenya 737.
So you could start pushing now, really. What are we at? Lights.
After 737 left to right, push and start approved. Osprey 27 Alpha, thanks.
We'll keep the power on just to keep the speed up a little bit. Sotsim's flying from Heathrow with Qatar in April. 777, then a 787. No, I've flown on Qatar, but heard good things. Yeah, I haven't either, but yeah, I've heard it's quite a nice airline to fly with. J45 has done this exact flight in real life. Mike, how are you doing? By the way, yesterday I spent an hour and a half at Triumph having get my motorbike looked at, and it turns out it just needed a little software update because the computer inside the bike was using an older piece of software, which was then having a bit of a brain fart with the heated grips on my motorcycle. So for some reason, it had a little moment where it just stopped working for 2 weeks. So what they did is they didn't even swap them out. They ended up just doing an entire software update on the bike, which has then solved the problem, apparently. So that's all good. I've got to say, the service was actually all right. And I can't remember if I told you guys, at least the channel members in the club lounge and Discord, I can't remember if I mentioned my clutch I thought was slipping slightly. Well, it turns out it was a little bit, because one of the little clutch bolts, the tiny little hex nut, had come loose ever so slightly. So it allowed a bit too much free play in one aspect of the cabling, which actually meant that at the higher speeds, if I opened the throttle, it wanted to slip, which is not great. But I've now solved it this morning. A little bit of tinkering. But I had this beautiful ride back on the bike through countryside yesterday, and it was all on my dash cam. I've got a motorbike dash cam thing, and I wanted to grab the footage, put it on my computer, and then share it with you guys in Discord in real life video picture bits. Never got round to it. When I finally managed to plug it in and sort of have a look at it on my phone itself, I found that, bizarrely enough, it didn't record that trip for some reason. I've got no idea why. It's always the way. Golf and then Kilo. Well, I think
Tower Osprey takes an office ready for taxi.
We'll keep going here and then turn right there.
Osprey 27 Alpha, testify GDS Golf Kilo, all short from this 06.
Taxi by Golf, GDS Golf Kilo, runway 06, Osprey takes an offer.
Nairobi Tower, Kenya 8656, gate Juliet 17, requesting taxi.
They're on continuous
Kenya
overhead panels. Checked.
The Osprey 8620 Neo, Juliet Golf.
Quick warning recall. And there goes Nairobi.
Behind the A320
Eurovision.
Juliet Golf.
Osprey doing a thing there. Ian says, okay, I've got engine 2 that won't fire up. Ooh. Check any failures in your PMDG, Ian. Or APU bleed, perhaps. What else could it be? Sean says that he flew with Qatar to Vietnam and they were terrific. Never been there, I would have loved to. Going Okay, towards the hold then, traffic mode on, TARA, squawk mode Charlie, we don't need terrain, won't worry about that, that's all good, and fuel flow, reset rates, FCP's all set, cross-checked, and just the lights to do now. Okay, 782's at the hold, ready for departure.
Kenya 782, line up on Mr. 06.
Line up 06, Kenya 782. This is what the BA flights used to do. So we'd get the ready to for departure call and then we would continue. The roll onto the runway. And they would illuminate the whole aircraft, so wing lights, everything, so that it almost illuminated a footprint around the aeroplane to spot anybody, because every now and again you get people running through the fence over there to try and get towards the aircraft. It was incredible. Little real life story for you. And hold her on the brakes. So, Toga, look at that. Sort out the drone camera to get a bit of a better angle here. For the departure. There's a screenshot, that's cracking, isn't it? Couple of Ospreys, so Kenya in the middle. Lovely. And then, 1-2-8 after departure. Is, you know what, that's why the channel name became British Avgeek, because the letters were BA. I was going to think of different ideas for channel names, but because I loved my time at British Airways and all that kind of stuff, I wanted to have a B and an A in it, so it formed the first letters of the title. Runway 06 clear for takeoff, can you 782? So yeah, that's how it became British Avgeek. Okay, sticks forwards. You can see the windsock over there. Brakes off. It's an ever so slight crosswind. I won't worry about that too much. Engines are good at 40. Toga. Proper Toga takeoff this. Speed's alive. Waiting for that call. There it is. Power set. 80 knots, just relieving that nose wheel pressure now. Not using very much rudder at all, so I've completely neutralised the aileron inputs that I was making. Don't need them. Hot and high. Here we go. Rotate. Don't know what caused that weird viewpoint zoom out thing. Gear up. I have absolutely no idea what's caused that. That's very weird. Anyway, there we go. We've only gone and up. Awesome. Let's fly the plane.
Kenya 782.
Engaged.
28. Nothing further for you. March here from 1-2-3.
Leave her off. Auto brake off. Runway turn off lights off. 1-2-2-8 for Kenya 782. Thanks to the ATC. See ya. Engine start mode selectors off. And on the turn. Watching our flap acceleration speeds, and we'll keep it turning round.
So our heading matches.
1-2-2-8. What do we got? There's my favourite one. We'll set flap one. And rolling out. Out of Nairobi. She's in the background. And we'll go flap zero. Never been to Bacau in MSFS, no. How are you getting on, Ian? Have you solved it, or are you having more problems with the engine start sequence? That's just a vast nothingness. See, that's the city of Nairobi. I'm trying to think where the hotel was that I used to stay at. Because it was really, really stunning. I reckon it's over there somewhere. Because that looks like a national park. It was the old US embassy anyway. I forget the name of it. Olayeni or something like Olayeni. Ooh, maybe it was Olayeni. All Sereni. I was close. O-L-E space S-E-R-E-N-I hotel. And from what I said, it's the old US embassy from years ago. Standard pressure. Through 250. We'll keep a climb into 360. 171, that's fine. Make sure that's just in with our heading. And we're only about 5,000 feet above ground level, so we don't necessarily need to turn the landing lights off just yet. I'm going to look for it on a map. Yeah, there it is. Mega. Overlooking the Nairobi National Park. So where's my satellite view? Trying to work out where Nairobi Airport is in relation to it. Oh, Jomo Kenyatta. Oh, okay. It's actually closer than I realise. If I just do... Where is it? Crikey. Let me just turn the chuffing lights off first. If we go this view, where's the airport? That's the airport there, isn't it? Oh, crikey, where's the airport gone? So this is the national park here. In fact, there's the airport. Found it. So Ol Sereni was literally there. So there's the river going through. And there's a big junction here, and just beyond that junction is a little road, that's Ol Sereni there. And the pool used to overlook this national park here, and you would see giraffe, elephants, things like that, kind of just wandering around, and it was just the most incredible thing. So hot. That's I put some ultra sun stuff on there on a trip, and it was meant to be ski level, like good. Swiss company and all the rest of it, and I think I had a faulty batch because I've never been so sunburnt in my life. Delta Tango morning. It was indeed, wasn't it? Always love a little bit of African ATC. It's nice that this airport, well this kind of this region now, or the African continent rather, is starting to get a little bit more scenery, a little bit more love from different developers, freeware and payware, because ultimately we're not really seeing many, are we? Let's face it. We've got the likes of this lovely Zambia scenery that we're flying to today. It's probably one of the higher detail ones that you can get. Wow, we've got a whole custom sound pack from Luke Airtel. There are parts of Africa that are actually quite dangerous, and in fairness, parts of Nairobi are as well if you're from the west. I've told you guys stories of all these African countries that we used to go to, so like Ghana, Nigeria, Nairobi, did we have an armed guard at Nairobi? I don't think we did. Or did we? I can't remember now about Nairobi. Certainly, Ghana and Nigeria, we had armed guards. We had G4S in a big Hilux truck in front of us. And then we had this armed guy who called himself a commander. He was our commander, and he'd come on the bus with us, the crew coach. And we'd be escorted via, with about six different armed people, armed security, to and from the hotels. Certainly in Nigeria for Lagos and Ghana as well. I don't think we had the armed protection in Nairobi, but if you went to the wrong parts of Nairobi, then you'd be in a lot of you'd have a lot of problems very quickly. So we were quite limited and restricted into what we could do and the kind of things we could go and do. So we would go and visit the elephant orphanage and the giraffe sanctuary and things like that. And they were the kind of approved things that we could do. Delta Tango. I didn't know Victoria Falls had an advanced payware scenery. Interesting. Let's get these other screenshots on here. Hey, guess what? We've got Livingstone Tower online. Mega. Which means we have an ATIS, and therefore, oh god, what's the airport code? FLHN. Therefore, we should get some sort of weather report. Ah, boo. Maybe soon. Maybe soon. That'll be a great help. These clouds look lovely, don't they? Look at the ground below. Rab says Kenya Airways got such a nice livery. But Johan is reminded of Kellogg's cornflakes by the paint scheme. Yeah, beautiful part of the world. And I do want to go and visit parts of Africa for a holiday at some point, to be fair. I've always wanted to go to South Africa, but everything I see now that's going on around Joburg, Cape Town, just like armed robberies, all sorts of stuff. So it kind of puts you off going there. Because yeah, ultimately you want to feel safe where you go. Not necessarily myself. I can look after myself and I can use whatever's needed in the environment that I'm in. But the missus... I wouldn't want to put her in a position where she felt like there was a risk or threat to her life. Osprey 27 Alpha's airborne behind. Badger's ahead of us, in fact. I assume you're flying offline today, Badger. Kenya Airways cargo, 737-800. Osprey 27 Alpha's up. We got Nighthawk Osprey 1867. And Justin, Kenya 8656. Oh, loads of screenshots already from Justin. Nice. So top right over there, can't really see it, but in that image, the very top right, above the wing, centre of the aircraft, draw a line straight up, and there's this little patch of greenery that kind of arcs around in the corner. That's where the hotel that I used to stay at is located. Lovely place, Old Sereni, lovely hotel. I'd love to do a safari. Great screenshots. Yeah, that'd be me on the threshold. There I am. Rolling on past. Who else have we got? Kenya 782. Airborne, and that's all of us. Oh, Ian, he's airborne. Happy days. That solves that then. He's in the 737-900. Osprey 2472, our final pilot of today. This is probably the best way to show it, actually. So, threshold of 06 is there. And the road would take us all the way down here. This is the National Park. Nairobi Wilson Airport. Around there. Right, yeah, so it's in this little bit here. We're on the southern bypass. That's where the Old Sereni is. In this kind of little section. The elephant sanctuary was not too far off from there either. Which was great. Or elephant orphanage. Justin, nice. Crikey, Delta Tango. Who makes that scenery then? Perhaps we could do that next week at some point. Look at that lake in the background over there. Stunning. That is... Ooh, actually, what lake is that? That's the huge one. That's Lake Victoria. Wow. Is it? No, surely not. Lake Victoria's got to be like all the way over there somewhere. That one is Lake Natron, I think. And then Lake Manyara will be flying over that. So we're in Tanzanian airspace now, folks. My lack of doc. It's either dangerous near-death experiences, or beautiful views, or sunburn, and that's it. Copper, welcome. Good morning. Starting his work day, enjoying the stream so far. Absolutely, Captain Biggle. Stay in the right places and you'll be fine. That's pretty much the advice that I was given, actually, to be fair. You stay in the right places, and you follow the security advice given to you, and you are okay. Look at that. In the background there. Wow. It's a really stunning part of the world, isn't it? And I know I've said it already, but it's great to see developers now create some lovely scenery for this region. because it's underrepresented, it's neglected a little bit in the community, I think. You look at Europe, and I get most simmers are in the US, they're in Europe, they're in Australia, they're in Asia, but actually some of these regions have been completely filled with fantastic quality payware. The version that we're flying into as well, this Livingstone airport scenery in Zambia, it's only at the minute available on Sim Market. Hopefully in the future it might be available somewhere better like Contrail, but the developers are doing a lot of work on it still, so it's very much a work in progress airport scenery that's been tweaked and updated already a few times. The updates that we've got today, version 1.4, I double checked before the stream started, downloaded it fresh. Version 1 is on Sim Market. The developer, 61 Tree Studios, have done a lot of work over the last couple of days, knowing that we're going to be streaming this today, in adding a couple of extra features, neating a few bits up, and we've gone from version 1.0 through to 1.4 in about five days or so, approximately. So little tweaks here and there. He has said that it's heavy on performance currently, and it's not going to be optimised until the airport is complete or at a point where it seems finished, and then the optimisation will begin, because it's the developer's first ever payware airport scenery and they're learning a lot as they go through the build process. But it looks really good, and I think at the minute, I think on Sim Market it's about 13 euros, I think, roughly. £12-13. And of course, eventually on Contrail, if it gets on Contrail, you should be able to transfer your license across. At the minute, I'm trying to persuade them to reach out to Lars at Contrail to get it listed on there. But all the links are down below. The links to the Payware Livingstone and that Nairobi that we've just taken off from. So if you do think, oh, I like that actually, I'll download those. Then you'll be able to grab both via the links in the description. Christos, good afternoon in Switzerland. Hope you're well. Oh, look at that. I've always wanted to go to Tanzania. The only place in the world that you can get Tanzanite. Well, Justin, Sim Market isn't really about quality, it's more about how many products they can sell to line their own profits. So 85% to 90% of products in Sim Market are just god awful trash, and they don't care, they just want people to pay via Sim Market, so Sim Market makes tons and tons of money from it. Not great. So I usually actively avoid Sim Market. It's the only place, though, you can get the Mad Dog, the MD-80, which is really cool. Rab, nice. First flight in the Kuro 787. I'm guessing you're offline as well, right? Look at that. Let's go outside, see if we can get the scenery pop. So if you haven't flown around this part of the world in Microsoft Flight Simulator, this is the reason why you need to give it a go. Pick a location. maybe even tour across the entirety of the continent, stopping off at different countries along the way, because it's just exquisite. It's remarkably nice, isn't it? Carlito says, I'm so happy to see a Microsoft Flight Simulator YouTuber fly around the African continent. Yeah, it's not really done enough, is it? And I don't do it enough either, to be fair. And it's such a huge continent in reality. With a lot to see. Yeah, giving us the choice, everyone flies around the EU and the US. It's good to see some diversity, Carlito says. 100%. Hopefully it inspires some of the other content creators to dive in and do the same as well. We're flying in this little pocket today. In fact, I'll do it on charts instead, because it's a bit more snazzy. Let's hide that. Which one's satellite? Ooh, that's cool. How'd you do satellite? Switch to night mode. Ah. World map. Or satellite. World map. So, out of Nairobi. A little magenta line there is our little route for today. There you go, it fits into the screen quite nicely there. But then you've got Mozambique, you've got Madagascar, you've got Zanzibar and Tanzania. And you zoom out and out and out. You've got all of that to go and explore. And most of it is neglected by a lot of developers because partly because it's an area of the world I don't think many people actually fly around, and therefore for a business point of view it doesn't really make much sense creating payware scenery for it. But we've got a good Cape Town and a Johannesburg. Some of the gaffer sim scenery in South Africa is very nice. We've got that Windhoek airport as well that we saw in Namibia. God, who made that? We did that a little while ago, didn't we? And that was a really nice airport, and I can't remember if it was payware or not. Yeah, so many different countries listed around this part of the world. São Tomé and Príncipe. Lots to see. Gives the Outback a run for its money, doesn't it, Justin? This landscape. Look at that. All the different colours and things. Pretty cool. I think this is where there's a YouTuber called Itchy Boots, and she rides around on her motorcycle around Africa. And I haven't watched any of her videos yet. They're on my list of different things to watch. But it looks quite intense. It looks like she goes to some wonderful places as well. But also gets robbed by different authoritative figures throughout the journey. If you like motorcycles, probably a great one to watch. Justin says he's off to the Western Australia Pilbara on Thursday and Friday. Red dirt up there and gorgeous. Going to have to Google what that is. Alpha Bravo, good morning. Oh, Rab, you followed her for a couple of years, Itchy Boots. I didn't know that was her name, actually, to be fair, either. How come... So, a question I've got, I haven't really... Because I haven't started watching her yet. How come she's decided to go and ride around Africa on a motorbike? Does she live out there now? Copper says she's just, funnily enough, popped up on his YouTube feed over the weekend. I'll give her a watch. Maybe it's the algorithm tricking us all. Million subscribers, my goodness. That's why she does it then. Probably just about get a living off that. That's a remarkable figure, my goodness. Rab says she lives in the Netherlands, or lived in the Netherlands, sold a house and now travels the world. Wow. Canadian Flight Simmer, morning. Hope you're okay. Delta Tango says Windhoek appears to be a stunning freeware on flightsim.to created by Shaq. Windhoek, MSFS. I can't remember if we used the freeware one or if we bought the FSDG Windhoek. I'll tell you what, the freeware one looks fantastic, doesn't it? Let me share. I'll share the link to that in the live chat for you guys, because Windhoek is a beautiful... I don't know if you, some of you will remember that trip that we did. Windhoek to Cape Town, wasn't it? About 6 or so months ago. And there's the link in the live chat. It was absolutely remarkable. Some of the colours and the landscape around. Just incredible. I think that was a high altitude runway as well. From memory. I think that was one of the nicest sceneries we've seen. As in landscape and everything else. I think you're right there, Delta Tango. I think I purchased the FSDG Lite Windhoek. And then was really annoyed at the fact that actually I should have just got the freeware one, which is what I've just linked. The freeware one looks remarkably good. Maybe we need to go there again. In fact, Zambia, we could do, I wonder if there's a flight from Zambia to Windhoek. We could do that next week, couldn't we? By Shack 991. Yeah, he makes some good sceneries actually. Hey Rab, member 13 months, thanks for the ongoing support. Time flies indeed when you're having fun. So 36, 208. Let's get this turned up. And we're looking pretty good. So we just passed Needex. We've got Eptic coming up. 8.9 tonnes is what we want on our fuel. Let's just look at our... 8.8 is our estimated. So it looks like we're on track for a fuel burn. I did turn the APU off, didn't I? Yeah, good. So that's one thing we could have done. Kept the APU on and used the air conditioning packs through the APU to get power out of the engines for takeoff rather than using some of the power for the aircon system, but we didn't need to today in this. If we're flying a much bigger aircraft, this might be something we can consider. Zanzibar freeware is excellent as well, Rab says. I think there's a Borelli. Have we gone to Borelli, Zanzibar? That's a payware. Okay. Well, I've just seen that. Let's have a look at the freeware. Oh, they look totally different. Well, there's a different one here. Oh, okay. Wow, Zanzibar. This is the one you want. There's two Zanzibar on flights, flightsim.to. That's the one you want. Is there a scenery for St. Helena? Johan. What's the flight time for that as well? We could do that. I've been meaning to do that for a couple of years. Oh, Super Spuds made one of those. Although we put that on 3 years ago. And it looks pretty naff. I think that's probably one of his worst sceneries. Auto-generated airports. The airport, it doesn't exist in MSFS, so they've added it in. Kyung.com has put one in as well. I tell you, the airport, the actual island looks so bad. That'd be one heck of a tough approach, wouldn't it? And then it's going on about GSX Pro. If you've got Navigraph, delete the Navigraph BGL file. It just gets too complicated then at that point, and I start to switch off from it. Justice says, we all know it's hot in Africa, but Perth, Western Australia, has just had 43 degrees today, 44 degrees yesterday, and 6 other days above 40 degrees this month. It's their hottest February on record. Oh, wow, look at that. I mean, it's worth pointing out, those of you who don't know, Australia is in its summer at the moment. That's not their winter temperatures. Imagine if that was winter. Jeez. Lorenzo, welcome aboard. Thanks for subscribing. Yeah, what's the flight time from Windhoek to St. Helena? Our brother says, has anyone had issues ordering from PredeskSim? He ordered an A320 throttle set for his Honeycomb Bravo nearly a month ago. Got a receipt for it, but no comms since, despite several attempts to contact them. That doesn't sound very good at all. See if we've got any was it FLHN? Any ATIS yet? No. Well, that'd be interesting. Well, St. Helena could be a really fun one, Badger, because it will be incredibly tough as well. I don't know what the flight time is, though. I don't know if it's the sort of thing that we could do on a stream, if it's more than sort of 4 hours. I'd have to time it with a day that the missus is in, so that the dog gets looked after within the 4 hour kind of thing. And this is 21 to 23 hours because there's no direct flight. FYWH to FHSH, isn't it? So if I go on SimBrief, I'm going to punch it in. I'll have a little look at what the block time would be. FYWH to FHSH. And well, what would we do it in? A320. A320neo. We'll punch that in first. 4 hours, 5 minutes block time. It's a lot of water. Not too bad though, actually. About 3 hours, 40 block time. Oop, that's the microphone. If it's something you guys want to see, we could do that in the next couple of weeks. Windhoek to St. Helena Island. Not sure what the biggest aircraft it could take. Ah, well, Justin, hold on. So, fly-by-wire have shared one more image of the A380. I'll just go onto Discord and find it, he says. Is it in progress? Yeah, it's in progress. Here we go. Open image, a new tab. Right. Hopefully, you are ready. Just make sure I've got this sorted out. So it says, we've made good progress on the A380X in the last few weeks, namely an integration of our custom FMS together with the appropriate pilot interface and the multifunction displays. The integration of the onboard airport navigation system and various improvements on all instruments. Keep an eye on our YouTube for progress updates soon, it says. And it looks like that. Hold on, let's make this bigger. There you go. It's a very low resolution image, to be fair. But it looks pretty mega. There's the OANS in that MFD2. We can see that looking very good. So it looks like it's coming along really nicely, to be fair to them. Bear in mind, this is going to be freeware when it comes out. And it looks spectacular. Really, really spectacular. I'm incredibly excited for this. But again, I don't know how far away it is. I would expect Microsoft Flight Simulator 2024, perhaps, for this to appear on it. And in that time, I wouldn't be surprised if then Asobo or Microsoft turn around and then try and get them to pay for it. That sort of thing. But hopefully it will stay freeware and the rest of it. Yeah, a remarkably incredible machine, Rab. 244 tons at takeoff. Insane how these things fly in sustained flight. Just remarkable. And still, I've said it before, I'll say it again, still to this day, the most powerful, most impressive, most smoothest aircraft I've ever flown on in my life. Jesus says, do you think the date on the tablet means anything? I didn't see the date on the tablet. Let me have a look. You know what? I said this the other day. Does anyone else have problems with the new Discord mobile app? It's absolutely awful. I actually can't see the date on the tablet because the image is too low res. Oh, hold on, now I can. Sunday, May 19th. Oh. So that's 3 months away. Maybe that's a day that they're targeting then for some sort of release for it. But until it actually appears, I wouldn't say that necessarily means anything. Yeah, the PMDG 777 will be good. Well, next update, May the 19th. Yeah, could be that as well, couldn't it? Always difficult to pick, to work these things out. It's easier to not get too excited. This time last year, so February 2023, in the live chat, I remember streaming roughly around this kind of time of year, and it was like, oh, the Flapper Wire A380 is going to come this year. And I kept saying, absolutely not. It's going to come in about 2024, probably. And people didn't believe me, but here we are, February 2024. Still nothing. First flight out of LCY. So, Wesley will. Wesley will bring it into London City for us. No doubt. Or Zato. He'll fly out of the Vulcan, then in an A380. Hey, Justin, been with us 26 months gold. Thanks for the ongoing support. Yeah, Ian Allen saying in the live chat. So this is FS Weekend in Lelystad, Netherlands, on the 18th and 19th of March, I think, isn't it? PMDG are attending, and they've said that there might be, if all works out, might be able to play with a secret project, which then won't become secret. Saying that, I wonder what the surprise announcement from PMDG at the European Flight Sim Expo will be. Personally, I really hope it's going to be something like a Boeing 767 or a Boeing 757. That'll be mega. That'll be so good. But with these things, it's always hard to tell, isn't it? So we just have to kind of hold back and wait to find out. Ian says a Boeing 727 would be cool. Yeah, perhaps they'd do something a bit unique like that. Because that'd be quite popular as well, wouldn't it? I'm trying to think what else they would do. Unless it's the 787, and they've taken the lack of quality wings 787 and actually thought, you know what, let's make a payware one. But then we've got three fantastic freeware 78, well, two fantastic freeware 787s that work with the Asobo 787 in Premium Deluxe now, thanks to Horizon Sim and Kuro. But I suppose a payware one would be a whole different level, wouldn't it? Whole different world of realism. Carlita says a 747-400. But that wouldn't be a surprise, would it? Because they've said that they are working on a 747-400. After the 777, wasn't it? I think they were going to say, what was the flow of releases estimated to be? It was the 777 next, followed by the MAX 7, followed by the 747, I think. So it leaves scope for another project. Because I think we've known for a while now that the 747 is coming in the future at some point. And we know it won't necessarily be Airbus. So the 747 isn't the secret. Flying Panda says the 777X, perhaps, and announcing the sim version will be ready before the real one. Yeah, with probably more reliability as well. There'd probably be one thing that's a bit of an overarching thing over the 737 MAX. Because it's the real life version is just plagued with problems. Avgas Kool-Aid is saying still holding out hope for their Jetstream 41 to be ported. I didn't know they made one. Johan thinks it's the 787. Yeah, quite a few people do, don't they? They all think it's the 787. Now Quality Wings no longer exists. I think someone was, we were chatting about Quality Wings a little while ago. Did we find that their company have been, the company's dissolved or something like that? Justin says, are there any more news on the sad scenario with Honeycomb? Unfortunately not. We made a lot of noise. Threshold made a lot of noise. And I think it's just still an absolute car crash. Yeah. As of the last couple of days, still no refunds whatsoever. Nick says the 777 MAX is in the background of one of the PMDG photos. Very true, very true. Although I think wasn't that the Pari Devco scenery that they just happened to be at, or was it in a PMDG paint scheme? I'd have to have a little look. Gavin, welcome. Oh yeah. The next time you'll hear me, I think, is this Sunday. We'll be on Sky Blue Radio, the Haggis and Poutine show. I mentioned it the other day, just in case you're not sure. I'll be live for an hour on that program. So you'll be able to listen in wherever you are in the world, flying and all the rest of it. Crikey, so one of the updates that I, when the this we shared the hot pitot tube image, and the hot drape, I think it was the hot drain pipes and things like that. And I go underneath aircraft every now and again if I have to at work, not always have to, but sometimes I have to just get underneath an aeroplane and do my work, and we do some training and stuff underneath the aeroplanes and things, and I haven't yet cracked my head on one of those hot drain pipes, and I shared a little thing on the PMDG forums on the 4th of Feb saying I've had a few close encounters with hot drain pipes underneath some aircraft, but thankfully never had one crack my head open. And Robert Randazzo replied back, I never got a notification for this, so I didn't even know until I've just seen it, saying, Luke, back in 1991 I caught the pitot tube on a Brasilia just at the front of my scout whilst moving forward. It exited at the back of my scalp and I was firmly skewered. Couldn't unskewer myself until a fellow ramper came and guided my head off the pitot tube. Oh my goodness. A bunch of stitches and a round of antibiotics and it was all good, but I still have the scars. When I think about it, I can still feel the burning from the hot probe. goodness. Am I logged in? I am logged in. What a story. Jeez. I'm trying to find the thing from the other day. No. Oh, did I tell you about the story? I was watching a guy open the toilets. Did I tell you that? The start of September, I think it was, off the top of my head. Or the end of August. I forget which. Did I tell you that story about the Qantas flight from Perth? And it did direct from Perth to Heathrow. So 15 hours, 15 and a half hours block time, these people would have been on board the aeroplane. And you can imagine the stench of the poop coming from the tanks as well. And this poor chap has to go and empty the tanks. So he positions the waste truck underneath the tail of the aeroplane. And I'm sat in my van with my colleagues. There's about five or six of us, and we were curious. We thought, oh, we've never been on that Qantas flight. I wonder if it's kitted out like Project Sunrise-esque. So we thought, let's go on and have a little look. We went onto the aeroplane and had a little explore while they were cleaning it, just to see what the layout of the cabin was. Spoiler alert, there's nothing remarkable about it. And actually, it looks pretty, pretty average, pretty normal. And then as we're coming off the aeroplane, all of a sudden, I just sense this movement. I can't smell anything yet, but I can sense movement. And I'm on the stairs on doors 2 left on the 787, this Qantas flight from Perth. I can sense movement down left. And I look down, and I noticed this guy on the ground underneath running, waving his hands frantically. So I look up in the direction of where this other guy has gone. Where he's running towards, and I can see the toilet cleaner guy, wearing his big white suit, his big what do they call it, biohazard suit kind of thing, and he's got his face mask on and all the rest of it, but what he's done is he's got off the top of the truck, and he's fiddling around with the pumps underneath. So he'd been fiddling with the pumps underneath. He'd on top of it, and he was emptying the toilet tanks, and that was all fine, and the seal was good, so it wasn't squirting all over him. But he hadn't realised, because he's focusing on that hatch whilst emptying the tanks, he hasn't noticed that actually when he last took the truck to empty the tanks of the truck out at the sewer pit in the airport, he hadn't shut the valve off. So as quick as he was emptying the toilets from this Qantas 787-9 that had done this this 19 odd hour flight from Perth to Heathrow, as quick as he was unloading that into the tank of the truck was unloading it all, all over the apron, and there was gallons and gallons of it all over the apron. And all I did was just get off them steps, get straight in the van, put the recirc vents on, turn the engine on, and then drive off. And all I could see was there was an engineer sat in a truck, wet in his pants with laughter. And he was obviously not going to go anywhere near it. This chap that had run underneath the plane to try and tell the other guy who was the operator of the toilet truck that he was leaking it everywhere. He was unfortunately stepping all over it, and it was flooding out, so he couldn't run away quick enough because he was already in the puddle, and the puddle was ever expanding at quite a fast rate. So all his shoes and stuff were covered in like poo, and And this guy on the top of the truck, all he could do is just jump down into it and try and shut the valves and stuff off underneath the truck. And he just stood there with his hands in his head, like, what have I done? What's happened? He had such an off day that day, the poor guy. But the stench, my goodness. When we were driving off, the smell hit us. And honestly, well, I've never smelt sewerage like it. Rob, though, says, Rob's topped that. You haven't lived unless you've sprayed by the sewerage tank from a submarine back off a 6-month deployment. Yeah, no thanks. My goodness, I couldn't do it. I couldn't do it. Have I got a picture of it? I don't think I would have taken a picture of it because it was so dank. Let's have a little look. So it's before I went away to Mauritius. So it would have been early September or August. Oh, it was August. 13th of August. And it was the 100 years Qantas aircraft. It was that livery. Oh, centre tanks. Look at that for timing. Almost empty. Master caution. Fuel. Let's pop them bad boys off. I work in and around Heathrow Vega, but I can't talk about what I do. That's good. Centre tanks are empty. Yeah, what a pisser. There would have been a few pints of at the pub. And one heck of a telling off from his boss, I would imagine, as well, the poor guy. As if being covered in 17, 18, 19 hours of poo wasn't bad enough. Matthew says, and that's why I avoid those trucks on my walkarounds. Morning, Matthew. Rob says, the sewage is better than slop, though. The food and waste, dirty water from the sinks and showers. Oh, yeah, I can imagine. Rab says, I thought it was bad enough getting drenched in diesel and oil. His dad asked him to change the oil and filter on his truck once, and when he took the sump plug out, it was a torrent and he got covered in it. Andrew, yeah, true. Andrew works on a farm just off Vancouver Island, I think, from memory, don't you? He says he works with cows and he's been crapped on, peed on, but you get used to it. Nothing worse than human waste or dog crap, though. Cows seem like no problem because you know it's just recycled grass. God, the stories that we get, that we accrue over a lifetime. Yeah, it was the 100 year anniversary Boeing 787-9 Qantas livery, and it done the rotation from Perth to Heathrow and back, and the cabin was really generic, and I thought it just looks like a normal Qantas cabin. And I kind of expected to go on board and see a whole kind of, like a little bit how they've explained Project Sunrise, because of the sheer length of that flight. I was expecting to go on board and see like a fitness area, and then business class and premium economy, and that is it. But there was a whole economy section in the back, and I thought, I couldn't think of anything worse than, I mean, 12 hours is bad enough. I wouldn't sit in economy for 12 hours. I would pay the extra to go premium economy, so I don't have to climb over this other random stranger to go to the toilet, or if I want to go and stretch my legs or anything, because I like to get up and move about and keep the blood flowing around the body during a long haul flight. But I couldn't imagine sitting in economy for 18 hours. My goodness. Although I just thought to myself now, I've just had the kind of light bulb go off on, I'm going to check Seat Guru, because I'm curious to know if they've got a specific seat mapping that relates to their longer aircraft. Let's have a look. In fact, we go to that one. Yeah, boy. And that way I can show it on your screen. and I can also read the live chat. Yes, they've only got... they've got two layouts of A380. They've only got one layout of 7879. Yeah, it just looked like that. Very generic looking 787. I thought, is that it? Flight Tim says, I'm doing the flight. I just had to leave the sim for a few minutes. When I got back, I'd mistakenly tried to change my cockpit view, but it was your live screen view. Whoops. Have you been drinking? That's a lot of red seats here. But look at that. This whole section at the back, row 40 to 59, is economy. And that I couldn't imagine that for 18 hours. And row 57 doesn't have a window. Ugh. Hell no. It's a no from me. What have we got as well? Oh, row 40 to 44. Yeah, row 40 to 44 are also economy. And row 44 doesn't have a window either. Reduced width from row 20 for premium economy. So there's only four rows of premium economy on the Qantas 787. And then the rest is business. It was 3A, it's got very good reviews there. Look, standard business class, but provides additional privacy from the cabin. That's overwing premium economy. See, that doesn't look too bad, does it? We'll be curious to see how this translates into the A350 and what they then do. Melbourne to Perth as a domestic. The A380 is noticeably quieter. I'm glad this guy points that out as well, because the Dreamliner on board is just as noisy for me than a 777. The A380 though, insanely quiet in comparison. Project Sunrise may be innovative, but Qantas has some way to go. Plenty of one-stop options from Melbourne to Europe that are only marginally longer, much better and also cheaper, this guy says there. And that's from 2019, because Project Sunrise has been building and building and building for years. I will never travel in this Qantas aircraft again in premium economy, this person says. He flew LA to Brisbane. My goodness. That's a long one as well, isn't it? Terrible aircraft and below par Qantas service. Avoid this plane and the Perth to Heathrow flights. This is not the real Qantas, but more like Jetstar in a Qantas livery. Dreamliner or Nightmare Liner premium economy falls well short of A380 premium economy. Dreamliner seats are rock hard. The seatbelt has a big airbag lump in it, which is uncomfortable when trying to sleep. The seatbelt has to be undone when the tray table is used. All the cabin staff seems to be Brits with no concept of Qantas Aussie style service. For goodness sake, if you're serving wine in premium economy or business, I expect you to know which region the wine comes from. Cabin staff couldn't even tell me if the wine was from the east or the west of Australia, and they didn't seem concerned at all about their own ignorance. There are no window shades and the windows don't dim properly. This is not a bad seat, but it's a bad aircraft and the service not good. I hated people like that when I flew as cabin crew. Because I guarantee he would have, or she, would have boarded this aircraft already annoyed about something. And has then just continued to be annoyed throughout the whole journey. Stay out of premium economy unless you have a steel bladder. Since they share just four loos with 150 plus economy passengers, Qantas should address this disgraceful situation. Christ. Yeah. It looked pretty rubbish anyway. When I was going on a little bit of curious venture, I thought it looked pretty naff on board. And I thought to myself, there are a lot of different cabin configurations instead that I would choose before choosing that once again. Flew on a Qantas 787 from LAX to JFK. Was lucky enough to get an exit row in the main economy section. Fortunate with both my row and the flight being low capacity. I'm not sure I'd like to sit further back and would definitely not be flying London to Perth for 17 hours on this aircraft. Yeah, everybody's saying the same kind of things that I observed, to be fair. Very claustrophobic, small, badly created interior. It made me basically not want to do that flight. It's odd, actually, because for British Airways, and now more airlines are starting to do it as well, premium economy is one of the most profitable cabins that an airline can have. For BA now, business class, Club World, is the most profitable section, followed by premium economy. And that's a beautiful landscape down there. Followed by premium economy, and then economy itself. Usually, they'll make 2 or 3 quid per person. The lion's share is made up on the business class tickets. Justin says, Qantas are a nightmare here in Australia at the moment. He's a platinum member and fly extensively. Their flights from Perth to Newman, 1.5 hours airtime, is $1,700. My goodness. I suppose that's because they've got a monopoly on it. So they can charge what they want. If you need the flight, you'll fly it. Oh, there's a little dirt strip down there. Vanessa Hudson is worse than Alan Joyce. But she's basically the same person, I think. But it's interesting, all the kind of bad stuff about Qantas is still happening now Alan Joyce is gone. Matthew says they'll cram as many seats as possible in economy. Once the bean counters get a hold of the cabin plans, the only thing they see is the chasm stats. I will say though, the 787 is the best bird to jump seat on. Just ride in the crew bunk and nap in the bed when above 10,000 feet. What a way to commute. Ian says it's because there's no open skies here, they can charge what they like, and premium economy is massively expensive. Yeah, I noticed that actually for the Heathrow Perth segments. Economy was expensive enough, but they knew that the majority of people would want to fly in premium economy, and because there's only 4 rows, the price of those is almost double. And actually the price difference is there was only about 500 quid in it for me to fly a second sector, so go Heathrow, Singapore, Singapore, Sydney, or Singapore, Perth, whatever it might be, instead of the direct service. And at least then, 12 hours in, you're getting off, you're stretching your legs, you get a change of scenery, a bit of fresh air off the aeroplane, you get back on again, and then you're away. Well, I would probably do it in the Qantas A380. That probably be better. Or maybe the British Airways A380, depending on what routes they operate on. That's how I'd want to do it. I still would very much love to visit Australia. At the minute, there are a lot of schemes where they're trying to take folk like me out to Australia. And I think the latest scheme might be Victoria, or might be Queensland. And they're offering £12,000 to £20,000 towards moving costs for me to move out there. It's so tempting, but I'd never been. Justin says, Network Aviation, which is an acquisition by Qantas Freight, is striking at the moment for better wages and conditions. And he's off to Port Hedland on Thursday. The day they start another 4-day stand down. Oh, yeah, and you can't just hop on a train, can you? Although you can't really do that here either, because the... Bearing in mind, we're a tiny, tiny, tiny country in comparison to Australia. Our train network is just awful. It just doesn't work. I actively avoid trains. I would rather drive. Lord Al-Bakri, welcome aboard. Thanks for subscribing to the channel. Rab says it's £2,500 to fly from Edinburgh to Newark on a 757. Yeah, for that money, I wouldn't fly on a 757. I would expect premium economy or business class in an A380 or something similar. Vega, yeah, I think the Qantas A380s now stop in Dubai from memory. If my memory serves me right. But then you could also fly various other carriers. So British Airways, I think they go via Doha on Qatar A380s with a code share and a few other bits. Justin, what they need is an entire shutdown of the airline, like all the staff walk out at Qantas. A huge, coordinated, this isn't good enough. We all want the airline to be better, and we want our pay and conditions to be better, and our customer service to improve. Big work walkout kind of thing. That's what they need. But how do I close my doors in the PMDG 737 after takeoff? Probably a bit difficult at that point, because you should have done it before you took off. Pretty much, Ian, yeah. I'd never fly Emirates either. They think they are far superior than any other airline in the world, and they fly aeroplanes with cabins and crew uniforms that are as dated as the Millennium Bug. And I remember growing up, Emirates was this airline that you would aspire to fly on. And now it's just like an airline full of chavs. And you'll board the various aeroplanes, or you'll see like the you can walk around the terminal building. You can walk through a departures lounge. And I've now got so good at picking out who is flying Emirates based on the quantities of gold chains and hooped earrings and JD Sports track suits and those little man bag, shoulder bag things that they wear. I've got pretty good at working out who's flying Emirates to Dubai based on that. And it's quite entertaining. And I would never set foot on an Emirates aeroplane, ever. I walk on the cabins, the A380s, I've said it before as well, the A380s are so badly laid out with Emirates, they've somehow managed to cram in almost 100 more seats than a British Airways A380. There's nothing premium about that. Their in-flight entertainment might be quite good, but I also don't want to sit around 100 extra people. Lord Al-Bakri, technically no, because the way that physics works, you won't be able to just close the door on the plane if it's left open for takeoff. So you've got to make sure you close the doors before you push back. Delta Tango says he flew on a Delta 757-300 from Atlanta to San Diego, and that was great. Felt really new and fresh inside. Interesting. Callum, what airline is this? Kenya, because we are flying around Africa. Only just at the halfway point today as well. Interesting. So still got a way to go yet. Do you have any recommendations for flights with Osprey Holidays, Aurora Forza? Whichever you want. Usually the kind of is the touristy kind of route, to be fair. It's kind of what you want to do. Lusaka Control, 125. Lusaka Control, good afternoon. Kenya 782, flight level 360, 77 miles east of Itkan.
Kenya 782, Lusaka Control, ESA transponder 3474.
Reset transponder 3474, Kenya 782. Ah, I'm an OS. 3 4 7.
Lusaka Center, Kenya 792,
Kenya 7902 heavy. Lusaka Control, ESA transponder 3431.
Have a look on the website, Delta Tango. BritishAvgeek.com/MSFS-liveries.
Kenya 782, you are identified flight level 360, positions checks, proceed on course.
Roger, 782.
Kenya 7902 heavy radar contact flight level 400. Back action identified flight level 400. Proceed on course.
Control, Kenya 7903.
Control, good afternoon, Osprey, Tucson Alpha. Flight level 360 inbound, Itkan.
Osprey 27 Alpha. Lusaka Control, ESA transponder 3354.
Callum, nice, you're flying a long one there. He's ready to Dubai.
Northern
Turkey Speedbird 105.
And it's a 3354.
I'll back 3354. Apologies, 3354. Osprey 2 Alpha.
Lusaka Control, Kenya 8656, currently flight level 380.
Kenya 8656, Lusaka Control, reset transponder 3435.
I'll show you guys
resetting what we're flying towards.
So this is the 61 Tree Studio. Livingstone Airport, Harry Mwanga Nkumbula International Airport, FLHN in Zambia. You'll notice that it's got a shop. Opens at 8, closes at 10, so we'll have a shop that's open at the airport when we get there. Both hangar doors open by hiding your airplane yoke, either one in a double yoke aircraft. It says there, the goal of the scenery is to display the experience of actually visiting Livingstone Airport as much as possible by detailing the interiors, along with the surrounding buildings, and as a result, it's quite, it's on the heavy side currently.
We'll
go back after everything is complete to optimize textures and poly count as much as possible in order to help improve performance. And I've got a version which is 1.4. The current version on sim market is 1.3 now.
Course,
it's got 5 stars from 4 people already. Although Jürgen and Jürgen, probably the same people. So it's got 3 reviews. And these are the pictures that we've got that we're flying in towards. Little river. Look at the terminal building there, that looks really good. The little teaser of what to expect in the terminal structure. And that. That looks great. So we'll have a little look around this when we arrive. Looks pretty good. €13 at the moment. As an elephant. And apparently that baggage belt actually goes around, which is pretty cool. And there's the shop, I believe. The hangar doors. And there's a little overview of the airport. It's a very small airport in reality, but it looks wonderful. Ooh. And the version I've got today now has a control tower interior as well, which I think might be on version 1.3 as well. But it looks really nice, doesn't it? Little river around the airport terminal. There's the clock monitoring the shop opening hours, which will then close at 10 through the night, open again at 8, depending on what time you've set in the airport. There's the airport there. This looks pretty good, doesn't it? In pounds, £13.33 including VAT, €15.60. There's the price, including the 20% tax we have to pay here. As of the 12th of Feb, the scenery is 70% finished from his original plan. Due to the long development period, he's decided to release it early with the intent of releasing continuous updates until it's complete. And we should update one. We should expect one update per week. Things to come still, completing the buildings surrounding the main terminal, the ATC interior, more shops and interiors, the doctors and nurses room, security room, more vehicles and more animated people. And that's that. Looking pretty nice. I've linked it down in the description for today's live stream, so you'll see like underneath the live stream video, you'll see like a little button that says more. Perhaps you click that, it will then expand. Dan Voser says, is it like a bit of an African Pyrrhic? Quite possibly. I haven't physically seen the airport though, so I'll withhold judgment until we get there. Flyer deal paint scheme for the 7379, Albacker is asking. Go to flightsim.to, there's probably one there that you can download for free. FlightSim says, I did a lovely flight in the Phoenix, Alicante to Helsinki. Oh my goodness, what's going on? Did a lovely flight in the Phoenix, Alicante to Helsinki.
Kenya 782, Lusaka control. Do you have an arrival plugged in for the Foxtrot Lima Hotel November?
Yeah, I've got in the plan Avuma 1 Alpha arrival via APKIM RNAV 10, but I've got no weather data. Kenya 782.
You can plan for the Avovo 1 Alpha and the RNAV approach for runway 10 at Harry.
I will go over 1 Alpha RNAV 10 at Harry for Kenya 782. What was I saying? Yeah, there. So Flight Tim Sims comment, I did a lovely flight in the Phoenix Alicante to Helsinki. The aircraft wouldn't pressurise, the packs were on, the doors were closed, the oxygen masks deployed, and on landing he noticed he'd left the flight first officer's window open. Which in real life you would have noticed, but in the sim not so much. And I'm surprised, there should be more of a wind noise. You should hear like a big whoosh noise and that's that kind of thing. Right, we found ourselves in Zambia now, folks, for the very first time. And while we've got a moment, I'm going to pop 5 screenshots into Volanta and we'll have a look at our little fly along for today. Bosh. There we go. So, there's the remainder of our route now in Zambian airspace. Ahead of us, we've got Badger flying offline.
Kenya 792 Heavy, plan for the Avimo 1
792 heavy behind us in the 787-8 or 9. 787-8. And we've got Nighthawk behind Osprey 1867 with a couple of screenshots now. Looking good in the clouds. Oh, look at that.
Roger, at Harry Maringa, you can plan for the Avamo 1 Alpha.
Osprey 27 Alpha.
Approach runway 10.
And Kenya 8656.
Kenya 792, our destination is Victoria 4. Foxtrot, Victor, Foxtrot Alpha.
Kenya 792, Roger, disregard all message. And proceed on course. Standby for an arrival instruction.
Lots of contrast there. Beautiful landscape below. There we go. We've seen those ones already. Who else have we got? Ian Osprey 2472. At the back of the pack. Just entering Zambian airspace now. Some cracking screenshots of the wonderful Osprey Airways Holidays livery. I do love that livery. I think it's bloody brilliant. Really good. Zooming on out of Nairobi there. And that's all of us. Yeah, so Kenya 782 isn't actually flying to FLHN. He's off to Victoria. Instead, FVFA. Which is there. Victoria Falls International Airport. A little bit further south in Zimbabwe airspace. So he's flying a different, slightly, pretty much the same route, but a different arrival into a different airport today.
A34 heavy.
Callum, have I tried Explain 12? No.
For the arrival, continue your descent to flight level 090.
Flight Sim says, I've got a suggestion for Navigraph, a one-click button for the main map airport view, like you see if you zoom. Yeah, that's a great idea. So it kind of recognises that you click it for the arrival, or after landing, you click the one button, and it will zoom into then the taxi charts, the zoomed-in taxi charts that are always really good. I like that idea. I think that's very good. That would be something I would like to see them implement.
Lusaka Center, Kenya,
Justin says he's flying the Fenix A320 today with the mini FCU. Working perfectly. Can't wait for the version 2, Block 2 to be released. Sounds amazing from their press release. It does.
Kenya 8656, Roger.
It's still difficult to work out how far away it might be, though, for release. That's the only thing. Legs, we're running out of. So let's go into here. And let's put in our arrival. So, FLHN arrivals on AV10, APKIM transition, and the AVOM VOMU 1 Alpha execute. So, there's the AVOMU waypoints. Now, if I just go split screen with the charts. This is what we're going to expect. So, Avomu at or above flight level 180. We can see the constraint in the FMS there as well. So, that's correct. And then 233 degrees for almost 40 miles to Egvok. And then down to 6,300 feet. The initial approach fix at APKIM. Which is there. 063A APKIM. Turning inbound to Avoki, flight level 063, still at or above there, and then Exali, 4,800 feet, as it shows on the charts. So I'm going to trust the VNAV in this instance. We can see runway 10, 4.8 nautical miles GP glide path, 2.95 in the FMS, and it says 3 degrees there, but that's fine. And the minimums, so that, this shows that we're at a high altitude airport once again, so we're going to demand a little bit more from the engines. LNAV and VNAV, decision height for the MDA 3611. So we've got a whole lot of scrolling to do for this. And our descent forecast page is complete. What we can do is look at putting a, maybe a 4-mile fixed ring, or 5-mile fixed ring, and a 10-mile fixed ring. Then we'll know then when we're crossing Avoki and Exali. What does the missed approach procedure say? Contact approach immediately, climb 5,200 on 101 degrees, direct to Zanta and hold. Okay, so don't worry about that too much. That's quite a simple one, actually. So, runway 10. We'll do 5. And I'll do 10. Just because then that matches up with the glide path stuff on the charts. We're right on the border there, look, between Zambia and Zimbabwe. Over the river, beautiful. Transition altitude from departure is 5,000. So we'll go for a transition level of 60 on the way in. Harry Mwanga Nkumbula or Kumbula Airports. And what was the weather at Victoria? FVFA, isn't it? There we go. I wonder if we're going to get penalised.
Welcome back.
By New Sky for having an incorrect QNH in this instance.
Cargo 834 heavy, continue descent to...
Looks like the METAR doesn't like it in the chat, but I'll put it in there. Lord Al-Bakri, the time it takes me to go onto flightsim.to and find the link, you could do it quicker. Just type flyerdeal in flightsim.to's search bar, and then Bob's your uncle, you'll have found the answer to your question. It is really that simple. Three, six, one, one for minimums. So that's on Barrow. I'm going to start scrolling now because it might take a little while. Press hold shift to do the quicker scroll. My goodness, yeah. RSI inducing this. At least the Airbus, you just type it in the box. Good old Boeing. Giving their pilots wrist injuries.
Osprey 27 Alpha, Lusaka.
Go ahead, Osprey 27 Alpha.
Over halfway.
Plan for the Avamo 1 Alpha arrival. And the Arnav approach, runway 10, Javi Mwanga.
Plan for Apo 1 Alpha arrival.
Three, my
runway
goodness.
3611.
Osprey
27
Alpha,
thanks.
Here we go. Yay, we made it. 3611. Airport elevation 3,255 feet. That's as close as we can get.
3250
would be fine.
The transition from Adkim for the RNAV.
Justin saying, out of curiosity, Luke, how does sitting on the next level racing seat go for a 3-hour flight? So I've had it for over a year now. I've noticed the seat padding is actually, it's becoming a bit sunken. So this, the actual seat cushion that I sit on now, and I'm 72, 73 kilograms. That has now got a little bit, oh, we've been flying over the top of. It's got a little bit it's lost the padding, to be fair, which is a bit frustrating after a year, with some real solid use though, to be fair. But I do find it's not the most comfortable of seats for 3-4 hours of flying time. I fiddled around with the seat cushion, the backrest adjuster the other day, and I can't quite get it to sit quite nicely with my back positioning now, so it becomes a little uncomfortable at the back.
Eight, six, five,
but only slightly.
Control,
well, I don't know. I'd have to Google the pounds and the stones.
Plan for the Avamo 1 Alpha arrival and the final approach runway 10 via Adkim transition.
It's £160.
Prepared for the Avam 1 Alpha arrival.
Oh, you want stones and pounds?
Kenya
11.5 stones.
Osprey 2474 Lusaka.
Osprey 2472, go ahead.
Roger, plan for the Avamo 1 Alpha arrival and the Arnav approach from a 10 and Harry via the Adkim transition.
1014.
Yeah, prepare for the Avamo 1 Alpha arrival and expect Arnav for runway 10 via the Adkim transition for Osprey 2472.
So we go with that as a plan for the Q&H. And the runway length at Harry Wanga is 2,987 metres, 2,700 or so metres, and the taxiways to vacate are off in the middle, so we can set auto brake 2. Remind me a little later on, because we've still got a way to go to top of descent. 320 nautical miles, to be precise. It's Ian Justin flying along, also in WA. No ILS to worry about. Do we have any VORs? Yes, there's a VOR for runway 10. It's Livingstone 1125. That's an offset VOR.
Vanier, cargo A34 heavy, continue descent 5,500 feet. QNH 1017.
Set 101 in that, just because it's a point of reference for me to use, and 087 for the VOR in case we struggle with the RNAV. I've got the VOR then tuned in. I've got then another reference point with the course for me to use. There's an NDB actually as well, 308. Which probably actually better. That's also on 101, so we can use ADF 1, VOR 2. So we'll get Livingstone's NDB, LZ 308, and we will get Livingstone's VOR 1125 at the bottom of our NAV 2 or NAV 1 display there. No other charts beyond the SIDSTAR and the general airport chart. Missed approach holding at 5,200 feet, but it'll be about 6,000 we'll hold at. Look at that, no winds, just plain sailing. We'll flick that across to ADF as well, so we get the RSI showing ADF 1 as we've tuned it. We got that one, yeah. Rabbit says, around this time yesterday I couldn't change past fourth gear on his bicycle. Glad I wasn't close to home by that time. That ride though looked spectacular, looked really, really good. just going to do a test of the bot. So I want to make sure the bot is actually working. Oh, I think Nightbot has done something where it's refreshed itself. Is it back working again?
Bunny Air 834. It's Bunny Air Cargo 834 Heavy.
Let's try FVFA again. That's custom commands, meta, API, oh fetch. That's good. That's set. Send. Nightbot seems to have logged itself out. Methinks. Do do do. Let me just check the settings are in. Yeah, Nightbot's there. I think it's one of those weird quirks. Maybe it needs a minute or two. Well, it's picking up the YouTube feed actually, so it's definitely in. We'll give it another minute. Well, I'll try Heathrow Meta. Oh, nice, Justin. Flew in a chipmunk over Perth Central Business District with his club captain, but airtime and landing costs have skyrocketed. They have here as well. Keep smashing the like button, folks, throughout today's journey. Probably the last stream of the week until the other side of my working week. I've got nights coming up as well, but before my night shift, I've got Sky Blue Radio's Haggis and Poutine show to take part in around 2 o'clock UK time, that first hour. There we go. It's finally caught up. Oh my god. I saw all of the commands, and I give you all of the commands. Crikey. Well, at least it's working again.
Kenya 792 Heavy. Sadly, there's no arrival, standard terminal arrival route for Victoria Falls.
Good that's working again anyway.
Yeah. But once you close, I'll give you an initial.
So that's Victoria Falls Airport, which is the closest big airport to our aircraft. Our destination for today at Livingstone. But at least that's working again. I think it just needed a few more minutes to resync itself. It seems. Captain Locus says hello. I don't know how I'd do it either, Ian, to be honest. And I found the last couple of years, they've got increasingly harder. But riding my motorbike, it's probably the most dangerous time I can ride my motorbike on nights. Certainly riding home, after being up most of the day the first day, working all the way through the night for 12 to 13 hours, then riding home again. And I think in my car, because my car, I've got one of those kind of like hybrid Kias, and it's got this self-steering function, which assists you steering in the lane on motorways, and it's very, very cool with its active cruise control and all that sort of stuff. But because it means that there's even less for me to worry about, after a night shift driving home, it's really tough to stay awake for a 50-minute commute. But riding a motorbike, you know that if you fall asleep at any point, you're dead. So you end up going home very alert throughout the entire journey. Probably more tired than you realise. So I'd probably be making little mistakes here and there, or not maybe assessing other vehicles quite as I would during a daytime period when I'm not absolutely exhausted. But I find myself actually getting home very awake still, or seemingly very awake in comparison to me driving driving my car. Yeah, nights really tough.
3-4 heavy, clear to land runway 10 Lusaka. The surface wind 140 degrees, 9 knots. Call me after landing.
Everyone there, clear to land, and call you after landing. Bonnie 834 heavy.
That guy must be like, oh my good, oh my goodness, we got Lusaka control online. How? Welcome to the stream. Bok 834 heavy. Where was Abuja? So Accra is in Ghana. I thought Abuja was in Accra. Oh, there's Accra. I thought Abuja was in Ghana. Maybe not. Maybe I'm not finding it on the map quite properly. Finding myself zooming around various things. I think it's 1014. Ian. Yes, it is actually. Abuja is, it's in the centre of Nigeria. DNAA. And yeah, we used to hop down to Lagos. So Abuja, very dangerous it was. So we actually got to the point where we couldn't fly into Abuja and get off the aeroplane because of the dangers and the risk to us. So we then had to fly the 30 minute hop south down to Lagos to stay the night in Lagos before flying the empty sector back to Abuja the next day to get the passengers on for the next day's service to fly back to Heathrow. And same with Accra in Ghana. We used to fly into Accra, get off at Accra, and then we stopped because of security. We then had to do the hop across to Lagos. All fun. Yeah, true. It's all on balance, isn't it? It's all on balance. So yeah, it was safer than Accra and Abuja. Still not safe. We still had the armed trucks, G4S trucks, and the guy with the AK-47 stood in our coach, ready to react. It's a strange experience. And because of that, you never left the hotel compound.
Roger. Bonnier cargo H34 heavy.
So Tim, if you don't have aircraft installed, then the BMR won't work for those, and the liveries for those won't work because you don't have the actual aircraft installed, if that makes sense. But you could take the BMR from the website, download it, just put it into a random folder, and route your VPilot model matching bit into that VMR, if that makes sense. And then you should be able to see Osprey aircraft for ones you have installed in VATSIM. And if anybody knows any FSLTL livery creators, it would be really amazing if we could just do all of that via FSLTL. But I don't know anyone who actually paints for them yet. Beyond ATC have apparently released their pricing. Have they really? Let's see. Yeah, Flying Panda, not sure if it's been mentioned yet, but if you've seen that Beyond ATC have released their pricing, it's interesting. No, I haven't. I had a special FAQ at the bottom. Oh, there we go. Here we go. So what have we got here? Pricing information. Okay, it's on the website. Let's find out. Beyond ATC is dedicated to bringing you a high quality product at an affordable price. No subscriptions. You only pay for what you use. This one-time purchase of Beyond ATC will give you lifetime access to the product and all future updates at $59.99 US dollars. So we just call it $60, because that's what it is really. Full ATC, full access to Beyond ATC and all of its core features and future updates. 3,750,000 units of transition time. 6,250 free units of premium voice model. Offline voice model, generic voices locally using our custom AI engine using zero transmission time. And a basic voice model with 100 plus medium quality voices with many accents and uses a small amount of transmission time. Premium voice model is 250 plus high quality voices with accents from every country and it uses the most transmission time. I bet you'll actually go through that 3,750,000 quite quickly. Because doesn't it give you like immersive ATC? That's a lot of transmissions. And if, for example, you use a premium voice and it will use three times the amount of transmission time as a basic voice, I think you'll go through that quite quick. And then you've got a transmission pack, small, $5, and that increases your transmission time by 500,000 units. And a transmission pack, medium, $10, and it increases the transmission time by 1,500,000 units. Or transmission pack large increases your transmission time by 3,300,000 units. Transmission time is used to represent access to our award-winning voice models and online services. Every time you press the push to talk or Beyond ATC generates any online voice, this uses our online service which has operating costs. We avoid a subscription by allowing you to purchase only the access that you need by way of transmission time. If you wish to use push-to-talk, basic or premium voices, these services all use varying amounts of transmission time. When your transmission time is depleted, you will need to switch to offline voice model or top up with additional transmission time. How much transmission time is used during a flight? This is unnecessarily complex. How much transmission time is used during a flight? Naturally, each flight will use a different amount of transmission time depending on a few factors like ATC callouts, traffic volume, and player interactions. However, we've got some rough estimates based on our testing. Your results, though, will vary. No traffic. Offline voice model, zero transmission time. Basic voice model, 8,000 to 15,000 transmission time credits in one flight. Premium voice model, between 25,000 and 45,000 transmission times. With traffic in one flight. A premium voice model with traffic in beyond ATC will use between 150,000 to 600,000 transmission time. Is that the most expensive add-on in Microsoft Flight Simulator so far? Because for $60 you get 3,750,000 transmission credits. Hold on, let me write this down. We'll work out how much monthly this is going to cost, roughly. So 3,750,000. Say for example, how many flights do we roughly do in a month? Six? And naturally, everybody's going to want to use the premium voice model. We'll go worst case scenario with this. Premium voice model with traffic. And I'll take the middling. Oh, instead of 600,000, we'll go for 400,000. So already, in six flights, I've used 2,400,000 credits. Now, if that was 600,000, in six flights, I've used almost my entire credit gone. That's $60 empty in a month, which you then have to top up by another $60 or so to get the... Oh, no, so it's $20 would get you another 3,300,000 units, which again will last you a month. So that's $60 to buy the base pack, which will last for a month, and then every single month, doing six flights a month, you're going to have to top up by $20 a month and I'll ignore a month just for counting purposes. £280 a year for Beyond ATC if you did it every month. So how many people are going to buy that product for $60, use it for a month, then realise how insanely expensive that is, and then go, sod that, they can bugger off, and then probably either never use it again or just use the free version. That to me is wildly expensive, like almost speechless level expensive. If you use the basic voice model, that might use between 50,000 and 200,000 transmission times per flight. So if we take that as a worst case scenario, it's 18 flights. In 18 flights using the basic voice pack, you've run out of credit on your Beyond ATC transmission time credit thing. And that's with the basic voice model, with traffic. Dexy Boy 24, welcome aboard, thanks for subscribing. I was so excited for that beyond ATC. And look at this for pure marketing gumph. Is Beyond ATC a one-time purchase? Yes. Beyond ATC comes with a large amount of transmission time included in the base purchase, and that is yours to use from the moment you purchase the product. But if you run out, you may continue to use the product, but it'll be limited to the offline voice model and UI interactions unless you top it up. So you start with 3,750,000 credits, which sounds like a massive amount of transmission credits for $60, until you've done 18 flights using the basic model with traffic, and then you've run out, and then you've got to pay $20 for 3,300,000 units again. So 18 flights, it's wildly expensive, isn't it? Even the basic, if you use the basic stuff, you're looking over £100 a year. Oh yeah, the voice pack was something else. Where was it? Oh no, it wasn't. So the voice pack's already... The premium voice model is separate. You only get 6,250 free units of premium voice model. So it sounds like there's going to be an additional cost when you run out of credits for the premium voice model as well. What is the free premium voice time? We've worked out a deal with the provider of the premium voice model. They're giving all users a bunch of premium voice time to try out the service. Because it's the most expensive of the group, they want to give people a chance to use it without immediately loading up the program and turning their service off. So think of it as a little bonus amount for the time you get that only works for the premium voice model, just to try it out and see if you like it. They haven't mentioned how expensive that would be to get more credits for it. So I think you would look at 18 flights. You're looking at 3 months. So £60 for the basic service, $60 plus every 3 months, 12. You're probably going to look at 4 renewals. Or 3 renewals. So £120. $120 US, roughly. And that's having... doing roughly 6 flights a month. 5 flights a month across the period of a year. And yeah, if you go to an airport like Heathrow and have traffic on and it's mega busy, or JFK, Sydney, all those kind of big airport, Dubai, then you're going to pay in like higher levels of transmission time for that beyond ATC. Mike, Flying Panda, that's really shocks me. It's still going to be very, very good, but the pricing is unnecessarily complex, and it seems insanely expensive. It became a very good talking point, Flying Panda. Yeah, what do you guys think? Do you think it's a reasonable price? $60 base, and then $20 anytime you need another 3,300,000 credits on your Beyond ATC AI stuff. Because realistically, you're going to want to use it with traffic, aren't you? But don't forget, you've got VATSIM and IVAO, which are free, and you get actual people giving you air traffic control for free. Will it be available on Xbox? I was asking earlier. Who knows? Ian says, this calls for an on-stream poll. Well, we've got a little bit of time before top of descent. Let's start a poll. There you go. It's a yes or a no. Do you think, those of you watching in the chat, do you think Beyond ATC's pricing is reasonable? Yes, it seems fine, or no, it's way too high. Share your thoughts. And it'll be interesting to see what the figures will be, because we've got over 100 people watching. And if you all vote, it'll be quite an interesting little cross-section of how you all think for the developer to perhaps consider. Ultimately, for them, it's a business. They've got to pay for the AI use. They've also got to try and make money out of it and run the service. So they've got operating costs. They want to make profit as well. All the rest of it. Fly with Lados has just got in. How much is it? So it's $60 for the base pack. And then it depends on how much you use it. And that would then depend on how quickly your credits expire. But if you use all your credits... to buy another 3,300,000, it's $20. And that might disappear in as quick as 6 flights, or 18 flights, or 30 flights, depending on how much you use and how what airports you use and all the rest of it. Doc, hopefully not at the same time. Isn't Microsoft Flight Simulator's 2024 air traffic control going to be better? Ian's asking. You know what? I've got no idea, actually. Someone mentioned it the other day, saying if MSFS will use AI for ATC. I don't know if they would. I haven't read anything about it, so I'm not sure. Matthew says, I mean, VATSIM is free. If I really need air traffic control, I'll just log into VATSIM. Yeah, that's the point. Copper says VATSIM requires a controller to be online in order to get that ATC from somebody. But Beyond ATC gives you the authentic style air traffic control for every flight. So for him, he says the base pack seems reasonable. The boy C, welcome, says he will still carry on with VATSIM. Beyond ATC, for him, still won't feel real. We're not far to go. Crossing Central Africa.
Lusaka Center, Osprey 8656.
The Flying Panda says... if they had just released the base price first, it would be $60 one time for base voices and traffic. Additional premium voices will be available, an additional cost on a usage basis. Yeah, the whole pricing FAQ... Flying Panda is written incredibly badly, I think. It just needs to be simple, doesn't it? The base price is going to cost you... the transmission time credit thing is complex as well. They should just write... usage credits.
Yeah, not a problem, mate. We'll report back in 5 minutes.
Or something. Every time... just an explanation of every time you transmit, or every time Beyond ATC... provide air traffic control that you can hear, whether it to be you or different traffic around you, it will cost you a credit. And with the base pack, you start with 3,750,000 credits. If you get through that quickly and need to top it up, the top up will cost you $20 for an additional 3 million. That's all they just structure it like that. Mr. Season says there's also a difference between the basic and offline, which adds to the confusion. Everything but the initial $60 is about better AI voices. Troy says the best possible outcome, in my opinion, is for Microsoft and Asobo to do what they did with Working Title, buy Beyond ATC and incorporate their technology into Flight Sim 2024. Microsoft's got the AI servers and can bake this in. That'd be a great outcome, wouldn't it? Maybe it's an outcome that needs to be suggested to the folks at Asobo so that they look at it and go, interesting. They've, you know, Microsoft
and the sucker control,
have certainly got the cash for it, haven't they?
8656 back at the flight deck.
Can 8656 with sucker control, Roger.
46 votes already. 78% are saying no, it's way too high in pricing for Beyond ATC. 22% of you say it seems fine. I mean, just trying to understand the pricing structure hurt my brain. I am in the beta, but A, I haven't used it, and B, I can't use it or show it off yet. But I haven't even installed it because I'm not allowed to talk about it. I'm not even going to bother installing it yet until it's in, if that makes sense. But I don't think many people would ever use the premium voices. Not the way they've worded it, it sounds insanely expensive. So you would end up using the basic voices, but they would also use credits. So on that basis, for an average flight, you're probably, with an average amount of traffic, you're looking at 3 months, those credits lasting, before you then need to top up another $20 to get more credits for more basic voices. Which is interesting. Lightspeed, welcome. Copper says, I'm all about giving it a try to see if they deliver everything they've marketed. Yeah, I'm looking forward to seeing what it's like, to be fair. The pricing seems a lot higher than I thought, to be fair. Rab says he'd pay the $60 for good traffic injection and basic voices. They promised a lot. It looks really good, actually, on some of their products and stuff. It sounds pretty good. Yeah, the way they've worded it, terrible. If that's how it is, Mr. Seeson, it doesn't sound too bad, does it? Pay $60 for the app with lifetime offline voices and updates. If you want anything else, it's extra. But they've structured it in an insanely complicated, hard-to-understand way. and confusion makes people either worry or take it in a different way, or yeah, who knows. But don't forget, you can get FSLTL and run the traffic injector, which uses real-time Flight Radar 24 traffic to inject the traffic into your sim with a very small delay, and that's free. So as Matthew says, he thinks the basic air traffic control function of Beyond ATC for $30 would be reasonable. for him, traffic is kind of a moot point because you can just use FSLTL for that. You wouldn't pay extra each month for it to sound more realistic. True, David, yeah. FSLTL's traffic injector is then managed by the silly Microsoft Flight Simulator air traffic control, which is awful. Yeah. Whereas Beyond ATC will link all of that together. So it makes you feel like you're part of the simulation of the traffic being injected around you, whereas the FSLTL stuff just overlays it, injects it into your sim, and the sim will then just spout its air traffic control nonsense while you're trying to do your thing. So there is a difference there, tangible difference between the two. Auto brake 2, we've already checked all the data for the arrival, that's all good and set. Auto brake 2 is what we briefed, and 3250 is the landing elevation. Top of descent in 40. QNH 1014, minimums are set, and our landing weight is going to be estimated at 62.4. So we'll do 62.5. Flap 30, 145. And that's in the box. Odd DM on Discord that I was just responding to there. Justin's enjoying the African scenery, and Ancient Dinosaur says VATSIM is free and more fun. You've got real people listening to and responding to what you say, not just a server. But yeah, it does rely on having air traffic controllers around you and all that sort of stuff. Ian says, the days of a scrolling marquee across the top of your screen for air traffic control in Microsoft Flight Simulator 95, which had absolutely no interaction. Yeah, now look at it. Doctor on board says Beyond ATC is beyond our imagination and beyond our wallet. It's a high price point, isn't it? I think if they offered a subscription model at $5.99 a month, people would either use it for a month and then cancel, or they would use it and then complain about the fact that it costs them £5 or £6 a month, which is difficult. But it also probably wouldn't make them as much money as the way that they've structured it now, because they're immediately selling the base pack for $60. So if you were on a subscription model and you signed up for a month and you cancelled it for £5 or even £10, they've only made £10. Whereas if you only buy the base pack and use it for 1 month, they've just made $60. They've made about £50. And that's the business element of it, I guess. Doc says, I think their target market is clear for Beyond ATC. Those who do not like flying on VATSIM but still want higher quality air traffic control and traffic. And to be fair, there are lots out there. And that's their target market. Channel says they couldn't support the costs like that, and I guess they must need lots of money up front. Well, then it relies on the people they're partnering with not just vanishing and disappearing as well, I guess. The other companies. It's tough, is it? It's higher than I anticipated it being, actually, the price. It's difficult, isn't it? Because we've only seen marketing videos, which are always very specific in what they do. They'll have tested stuff, so it doesn't. It'll appear dynamic, but it's not actually dynamic in reality, because that's how marketing works. Would you rather spend the $60 to kind of coin Matthew's point there? Would you rather take that $60 and buy Beyond ATC, or would you rather, if you had to choose, would you rather buy something like the PMDG 777? For me, I'd use VATSIM and I'd get the 777. Wrong button. Oh, I think the controller's gone offline.
Parker.
I'll switch to Unicorn 1228, Kenya 782, and I'm at top of descent. Maximus, I have no idea what you're on about there. But there's the poll, 70 votes, and at least with how it's written and how we've understood it so far, it is quite confusing. 75% of you out of 70 votes have said the pricing of Beyond ATC is too high. Justin, thank you very much, buddy. Uber generous. Just gifted 5 channel memberships to 5 of you watching live today. So providing you've got gifting activated in your YouTube account to allow for gifting, you've all been in the pot. Randomly selected, thanks to Justin, very generous. So we've got Daniel, the Ancient Dinosaur, Lightspeed, Alibi 58, and Neil gifted a channel membership for the next month. Thanks to Justin. Head to our Discord server if you have just been named. Make sure you link your YouTube account into your Discord user settings, and if you're in our Discord server, it will get you access into our special club lounge. Flying Panda says, with the increase in AI functionality down to consumers, a lot of people are going to realise that AI is in fact expensive. Oh, Ian said he was having connection issues, to be fair. I didn't hear that. Thank you. Roy, good afternoon. Very fair, and that's very reasonable. Saying there he was prepared to expect that this would be the kind of price Beyond ATC have structured it at. For him, it's worth the purchase because he's not that kind of VATSIM kind of guy, and he loves AI traffic all around. So then you would get, for that $60, that extra immersion and the realistic air traffic control reacting in an AI way all around you to enhance that experience. For me, only from what we've seen so far, having not tried it yet, and having read through the website and a few other bits, and only knowing as much as you guys have seen and read and heard and viewed, it's higher than I expected, but I don't think it's massively unreasonable. and it is all down to how much you're going to use it and what features you're going to use. But they've not done themselves any favours in typing up an incredibly complicated, convoluted way of explaining their pricing structure. It just needs to be a lot simpler. And then if people understood it more, they might have actually think, you know what, that $60 is an absolute bargain. And perhaps the base model that won't use any of those transmission credits, whatever they were called, perhaps that's going to be good enough. What's nice, and Roy sums it up, is we've got the choice now. So one day you could think, I'm going to zip about on VATSIM, and then the next flight you look at it and go, well, actually I'm just going to fly this on Unicom, there's no air traffic control, let's dive in on Beyond ATC and let's get that functionality with the AI air traffic control to kind of interact with us instead. Would I use it? Probably not on streams, because I don't think it would work on a multiplayer scenario, would it? Mr. Seeson, I think you know a lot more than I do about it. Is there like a multiplayer functionality? Would we, like we are today, we've got 5, 6, 7 of us flying along, we wouldn't be able to connect together, would we, and have that interaction like we do on VATSIM? But I suppose that's a different market that they're not targeting, if that's the case. So the nearest weather, just as we're in descent now, folks, keep smashing the like button if you haven't done so already, that'd be great. The nearest weather is at Victoria Falls International Airport, which is in Zimbabwe, over the border. We don't have any weather at the minute at Livingstone, FLHN. Probably because it doesn't have a ATIS or weather station there, for whatever reason that might be, currently. But Victoria Falls Airport's wind variable 3 knots, cav OK, 34 degrees Celsius, dew point 11, QNH 1014. Flight Sim says, what was the software recently reviewed that was about £30 a month? That wasn't the one I did, was it? Was that 30 quid a month? Avi, mate. Avimate Pro. It wasn't that, was it? Oh, there's another virtual. Oh, Say Intentions, David. Was it Say Intentions? That's an AI-based US virtual ATC. I've seen that getting reviewed. I haven't got it. I don't think Avimate was that expensive, was it? No, there's no pricing detail at the moment for Avimate. So it must be Say Intentions then. Say Intentions AI. So it'd be interesting to know what other content creators have said about that, if they've been reviewing that AI product, and whether they've gone, oh, it's amazing for the price. Because if that's as expensive as you've just said, $30 a month. Jeez. Hell no. That's insane. $30 a month is disgraceful for a price for some AI ATC. How much is it pro? What's that? Pilot to ATC. That's £360 a year. For some pretend air traffic control. How much is pilot to ATC? Or pilot edge. Might be pilot edge. Because in the US, Pilot Edge, I think you get a lot of coverage, don't you, I think? How much is Pilot Edge? Pricing and plans. Where's it gone? Ah, chuff it, neck. Pricing and plans. So if you want combined, that's $34.90 monthly. Or if you want Western expansion only, $20 for Pilot Edge, and Los Angeles Center only, $20 a month. Yeah, Christ. This is what the dev said. We're now live and in our paid beta stage for Say Intentions. Interesting. So it's probably why they've reached out to some content creators for previews that have no doubt been overwhelmingly positive. And it's probably why they haven't reached out to me. Because at $30 a month, I think I would be fairly critical of that price. Interesting. I didn't realize it was that expensive. Say Intentions AI. And that's US only. My goodness. Almost, it's like, you know when you cut an onion? Imagine cutting an onion and putting your face really close to it so all of the onion spray goes in your eyes. It's like that. But volunteering to do it. Oh dear. Sublime Cantona. Hello. Flying to your home country of Zambia. Lovely. Hello, good sir. Would you like to fly to from Heathrow to Frankfurt today? Before you fly, if you would like to give me $30 for the month, and for each time you fly in this month, I'm going to give you half an onion to rub in your eye. Oh, yes, please. That'd be great. And yeah, I don't fly VFR. I think at that point, surely, you would be better off giving Pilot Edge a go for a month instead. If you're going to fly in the US. Because Los Angeles Center's actually pretty big, isn't it, I think? And I don't know what the Western expansion would include. I don't know. I've never really looked enough at Pilot Edge. But for $20 a month, you're probably better off trying that for 1 month first. Seeing if you like that. When they're online for 15 hours a day, as Mr. Seeson has said. And then go on to maybe look at one of these AI fangly things instead. And then you might turn around and think, you know what? That wasn't too bad. I'm going to just use VATSIM or IVAO for free. Let's keep it coming. What do we want? AppKim at 6.3. So we'll set that. Bring the range ring in. Sublime Cantona, well, I didn't realise there's a special Victoria Falls scenery for Victoria Falls. So I haven't got that, but hopefully we'll see a little bit of Vic Falls in the background somewhere in the distance on our approach. Oh, we've got centre back online, 125. Let's tune back in. Is this at... Is 125. Is he covering us? Big thank you, though, to ATC for today. I think it's Sub-Saharan African Division that do Nairobi and Zambia and stuff as well. Yeah, I mentioned it earlier on, Copper. It's nice to have quality options. So we have this breadth of choice around us in order to choose from.
Control, Osprey 2472, requesting descent.
Osprey 2472, clear for the arrival.
Thanks, David.
And descend flight level 140.
Descend 140.
I think this is a new controller.
Kenya 782, Lusaka control, are you with me?
Yeah, affirm Kenya 782.
Roger, continue descend to 6,800 feet, QNH 1018.
Continue descent 6,800 feet, QNH 1018, Kenya 782. 1018.
Controller Osprey 2 Alpha requesting descent.
Stand by.
Through 10. So the airplane's going to start to decelerate.
And Lusaka control Kenya 8656 at top of descent, requesting descent.
Stand by. Kenya 782, disregard their descent instruction there and continue to 6,300 feet to meet Apkin for the RNAV runway 10.
We could descend 6,300 level Apkin for the RNAV 10, Kenya 782. Little bit of speed break.
Osprey 27 Alpha, clear for the arrival and descend flight level 140.
Clear for the arrival and descend to flight level 140, Osprey 27 Alpha.
We'll go speed 240 for now. Did we put the seatbelt signs on? We did. Jolly good. So.
Yeah, was calling me earlier for descent was that Kenya 8.
Pause the music. I think, let's see if we've got descent announcement for the Luke Airtel.
Kenya 8656 at top of descent, requesting further descent instructions.
Kenya 8656.
We do.
Continue. Actually, descend now, flight level 140.
And
clear for the arrival.
Victoria is over there, and there is our first look at Livingstone Airport, Zambia.
And, we'll await for arrival.
Rendered in and ready.
Kenya 8656.
Mr. Caesar, yeah, they met off Victoria Falls Airport, says 1014, to be fair. We go 1500 for now. 1600 foot per minute should be then an idle descent, roughly. And we'll maintain 240. What have we got here? So, lights. Signs, pressure panel set, high altitude landing, but I'm not going to worry about turning the APU on and doing APU plaques bleed or anything like that.
Kenya 782 via Atkim cleared for the RNAV approach runway 10 and check your QNH 1014 now.
Evac Apkim cleared RNAV approach runway 10 and QNH 1014 Kenya 782.
And Kenya 8656 confirmed that you are cleared for the arrival.
1014. Martin,
arrival,
welcome. How you doing, mate? Paul's on the ground at FLHN. If you love the look of this scenery, by the way, when we get in, folks, then the link is in the description down below. Here's the turn.
Osprey 2474, confirm that you're cleared for the arrival.
Should probably slow down a bit.
Cleared for the arrival for Osprey 2472.
Osprey 27 Alpha, continue your descent.
210 minimum clean.
6,300 feet.
Look at this.
QNH, no, 1014.
Ian says, I had no idea Africa looked this good in the sim. It's beautiful, isn't it? really spectacular. Look at this river. Victoria Falls is up here somewhere. We won't see it today because we don't have the scenery. And Victoria International Airport is over the river. And that is Zimbabwe over there. And this is Zambia. Collimator, welcome. Ooh, who knows? Who knows? What do we want? 3611, isn't it? So we'll set 36. Flap 30, 146. Speed's good for gear down. Speed brake is armed, so we're coming in a bit fast, aren't we, folks? Flap 10. Justin says, want to say this is a great way to highlight flights in Africa that are often missed. Kudos. It's very rare you get scenery like this, isn't it? I mean, look at that. Coming in hot indeed. 180 though, and we've still got a few miles.
Reduce steer, final approach, pretty fast, clear to land, runway 10.
Runway 10, clear land, Kenya 782. It's like he has no faith.
Kenya 782, Roger, I'm showing winds now, 01021.
Roger, Kenya 782, thanks. Okay, let's just have another quick check here. Just have some final views. Look at that. Really nice. My throttles, my controls. Ooh, a little gust there. See that gust there? All of a sudden, 10 knots. So that's where... I mean, that's a prime example, actually. When we spoke before about different speeds and things like that. Just recycle this. We spoke before, didn't we, about speeds and how speeds... Your headwind of, say, 20 knots... All of a sudden might boost... at 20 knots and then drop off to say 5 knots. But actually, what will be the case here is speed being a little bit too crazy and then being too slow to fly. This is looking alright. Wind's a bit playful. Bingo. Reverse. Green. Eighty knots. My brakes.
Spray 27, seems like you meet the requirement. I gave you a heading, so proceed to Avo Key. Via Avo Key, you're cleared for the RNAV runway 10.
Just try and do this real tight here, because I'm conscious we've got someone on final.
The ONAP 10, possibly 2-0.
Look at that, airport scenery for the first time.
Aspray 27 Alpha, you can slow it to 170 or less.
It's actually quite a tight approach, isn't it?
170 knots or less, Aspray 27.
Yeah, someone's very far from home.
56. Continue your descent to.
Okay, so flaps up.
1,300 feet, QNH
117 foot per minute on the touchdown, folks. Okay, 1.08G.
Down to 6,300 for approach and 1014.
Getting all
for,
my buttons mixed
Kenya
up here.
86.
There's our first glimpse of the airport. Nice touchdown. Is that you, Paul, in the Kenya, in the
Kenya
Spirit?
782, make a left turn via backtrack 28 and parking at your discretion at the main apron.
Backtrack and then vacate, park at discretion, Kenya 782, and just vacating now. Thanks to the ATC.
See you next time.
See you next time. So just bring its speed down a little bit. We've got flaps up, speed brakes retracted. That's all off. We'll put the flight directors off. We don't need those. APU's fired up. Probes off.
Aspray 27 Alpha, you can resume normal speed.
Mission mode, taxi lights on, strobe steady to strobe for the post lights. Okay. Spirity, oh, I've got no idea what that is.
Kenya,
zero suitable parking.
You're gonna be able to meet Upcane.
I've got no idea what.
I don't believe that's gonna happen. You're still in the flight level.
What parking we've got here?
Maintain heading 265, continue descent to 6,300 feet. And radar vectors for the INAV runway 10.
So we get some Kenya Airways after landing announcements, see what they've got.
Maintain 260 heading.
I think there's a missing texture there.
Feet, awaiting for the vectors, Kenya 8656.
And I'm just going to have to go through him, sorry guys, but I don't want to venture too much off the line. He's obviously on the default scenery.
56 turn, further right, heading 270.
Let's see what GSX detects.
If you're able, speed 200 or less.
Turn right 270 and maintain
parking number 3.
Current speed for
that's over there.
Kenya 8656.
Osprey, she's not aware, on up established on the runway.
27, see what that comes up with. Oh, okay, that's there. I'm not going to worry about that.
27 Alpha, showing surface winds 010 degrees, 21 knots, clear to land runway 10.
61 Tree Studios in the live chat, welcome. Let's park right in front. We've got an interior already, we can see just about.
Kenya,
Mr. Gorshin
for 6, 5, 6, confirm, heading 2.
Leads. Oh, we've got somebody walking across the apron there.
Yeah, heading 270 for Kenya 8656.
I'm just going to have to plonk it here. This is not really a parking bay. One of those over there is.
Turn further right, heading 275. Turn right 275, Kenya 8656.
But this will do for now, I think.
2474.
Let's see if we can make this turn.
Your descent to 6,300 feet, QNH 1014.
I think Kenya Airways is part of SkyTeam, Paul, so it might be a SkyTeam but Kenya Airways livery, if that makes sense. Oh. Absolute corker. Oh dear. We're doing it. I reckon this is as good as we're going to get. And I'm pushing down on my flap lever as if it's my park brake. There we go. Okay, that's all good. Let's kill the power. Menu, FS actions, ground services, chocks, inserted. Parked up. Harry Mwanga. Let's get beacon lights off, anti-collision lights. And then we can do, let's see.
Kenya 8656, turn left, heading 124 degrees.
So we go menu, FS actions, ground services.
Left turn 142.
Left to 142 degrees, Kenya 8656.
Stairs.
Kenya 8656, speed 170 knots or less. After
we'll use the old PMDG ones, shall we? And let's get this camera set
speed,
up slow.
170, Kenya 8656.
MPS Gaming says, I hope we can get this on Contrail, avoid sim market so as much as possible as he can.
Then direct to,
I think I'll just revoke parking services at this point.
Left to 095 and then direct to Avakey.
That's
for,
easy, isn't
Kenya
it? Oh! Chuff and echo, missed him.
Osprey 2474, radar vectors for the RNAV runway 10 via Avo key.
Let's have a look
turn
at New Sky, look
right
at our
score.
16.317 profit and a nice touchdown, look at that. Little map routing across Kenya over Tanzania and then into Zambia. Right at the border of Zimbabwe. Really nice.
Osprey 2707 vacated 10.
Cheap fees here as well. That was probably a very nice landing that I've missed. Let's get the music back on and have a quick look at Volanta
Alpha,
to see if we've got any more.
Taxi via Bravo to the apron. Parking at your discretion. Use caution.
So Justin's next, Kenya 8656.
Taxi Bravo,
followed by Ian Osprey 2472. And I think that's all of the troops for today. So
Kenya 8656 via Avo key.
Let's have a look at sunset first. Live time. That looks very realistic. It's in the way the sun and stuff positions in the colours of the sky. Very good. We'll keep that rolling.
For Kenya 8656.
Look at that.
Osprey 2477. 7-4, turn further right, heading
backdrop's stunning as well.
275 degrees.
So this is version 1.4 from 61 Tree Studio. Still a work in progress. Elements of the airport still being tweaked. I would imagine this taxiway line here, this yellow line, needs to be extended across onto the apron as well. But a number of different tweaks have been made by the developer anyway.
Little fire
station.
Is at 10 to 9 o'clock on the RNAV now for
really nice lighting actually on the apron.
8656, 6300.
Hey, fam, I have the traffic
there's those little orange glowy things that we saw on the sim market thing as we were flying along the route. But the missives here look brilliant.
Break Kenya 8656, Roger, acknowledge you have the traffic in sight.
Let us know as always what you guys all think in the live chat as you're watching. It's been a great little flight so far. The freeware Nairobi It was very nice.
32472, speed 180 knots or less.
180 or less, that's pretty percentage.
Let's have a little venture to the other side of the airport. Past these big floodlights. We need lots more great airports in Africa to fly around MPS, don't we? Look at this. So night time looks really good. We'll then turn it back to the time of day that we were using a moment ago, which is about... should we go for midday? Probably a bit too bright. We'll go for about there.
Kenya 8656.
Oh yeah, the wrong livery.
10. Surface wind 010 degrees, 21 knots.
Little tall line of buses.
Philander runway 10.
And we've got that big trench there, which I assume is where the river is. Ordinarily. Or a river should be. Then we've got... ah, here we go. Here's that little water thing that we saw in the sim market piece earlier.
Osprey 2474, left turn heading 180.
Look at that. He looks amazing in 4K, by the way.
Osprey 2472.
We've got Ian on final. Just keeping an eye out to see where he's gonna pop up.
Speed 2472, speed
if any of you got any questions for the developer, by the way, 61 Tree Studio is in the live chats.
Speed
developer of this scenery.
And then, once
ooh, look.
Speed
a little flag white waving away. Hadn't noticed that earlier.
Osprey 2474, left turn to Avoki.
Left turn Avoki, Osprey 2472.
So we've got Justin on final now. And we've still got to go inside. There's an interior and we've got to go and see that shop as well that's open. Here comes Ian. Oh, here comes Justin, actually. Left turn, Avoki, whoever that was. I think the controller sent it to me by accident. Bill, welcome aboard. Thanks for subscribing to the channel.
Kenya, 782, disregard.
He's looking fast. His nose is down. Easy, fella. Oh my goodness. This is where we need like thinks he's flying an A-10 Warthog. He well recovered. Oh, there's smoke at the end as well. Chuffing heck. Planted it. Nicely saved.
2472.
That was sporty.
Clear.
Wonderfully done.
Approach, runway 10. Second for the approach.
Fire Avoki cleared for the RNAV approach for runway 10. Spread 2472, number 2.
Kenya 8656.
Center rug.
Continue taxi. Parking at your discretion at the
runway 10.
Roger, acknowledge. Continue taxi. We arrival parking at your discretion at the apron.
Continued parking taxi at my discretion, Kenya 8656.
Osprey 2472, confirm established on the final approach course.
Getting established on the
just working on them tactical landing start, Tango says, yeah.
Roger, what's your speed? Saved it. Accelerating on me.
Roy says his Mango still operating as an airline. I'm not sure, actually. Eva says International Airport, Airlink and Braer's and South African 737s to get you to and from South Africa. And this one that we've done today is a real world route, and it will then continue on to Cape Town, I believe. Once they've landed. So that's another option as well. I mean, if I just come up and around while we wait for Ian on final, and just recenter the drone camera. Look at this.
Aspect 2472 looks good now on my side. Clear to land runway 10. Surface winds now 010.
There's that little runway as well for GA flying and stuff. Little runway 33. And that circle up there, I think, is where the VOR is meant to be. I think Ian's last man in, isn't he? We do dog tag gamer, don't we? So a couple of elephants and stuff. Delta Tango says to 61 Tree Studio, the developer who's in the live chat today, said, "I think most of us appreciate an active developer who supports their work over time as much as perfection. You are clearly proud of your work. Keep up the good work." Yeah, I mean, don't forget, we haven't seen the interior yet. And this is a work in progress, lots more to be done. But as we can see from the bits we've seen so far, the texture work and the glass and things, really nice. And the night lighting, the emissives are very nice. Here we go. Last pilot in. Keep smashing the like button, folks. And then you can all rate Ian's landing as well. No pressure. Yes, and no static aircraft. It's rendering his aircraft as one of ours, so we've got our doors and our luggage compartments open, so it's replicated that on his, in case you're wondering. Those of you who watch all the time know what's happening. Looked like a great touchdown, that. He's flying. Oh, he's in the BBJ2, our Osprey Executive Jet. Beautifully done. Shall we have a little look inside Harry Mwanga Kumbula International, folks? I reckon we start with the air traffic control tower, which I think, if I've got it right, has an interior. Oh, it does.
Spray 2472, contain taxis via Alpha, to the main apron, parking at your discretion.
Oh, hello.
And continue the taxi via Alpha.
Rosonda Nogosa wedding, July 26th.
Taxi to the gate by discretion. Osprey 2472.
No problem. See you next time. Take care.
Bye bye.
Pre-shift preparation, initial set up. That's pretty cool. They've got a little staircase, a little sink, coffee machine, and then what's this? The break room. A couple of little hints and tips there for people. Nice. Let's dive in. It must be quite nerve-wracking, 61 Tree Studio, for a new dev to be watching the live stream with your scenery product that you've just released in the sim being actively looked at and reviewed. Matches the wall there. Good work, Justin. This is all pretty nice, isn't it? Oh, is this the ice cream shop? Lick it before it melts. $3.50 for a vanilla classic cone. That's a bargain. I need to go to Zambia and get an ice cream. That's the least of my worries. If I saw an animal hair in my ice cream, I'd be furious. Safari Ice Cream, distinguished purveyor of frozen delights, operates a subsidiary of 61 Tree Studio. Banks, little ATMs down there as well, and the toilets. Got to know where the Kazi is. I think there's a shop somewhere, isn't there? Flavors Cafe. I assume it's up here. Yes, follow the signs. This is the cafe. Remind me, check the info desk, 61 Tree Studio says. Where's that? Ah, this one. No way. Yes. But now it's always one of the best sceneries in Africa. Love it. We've got our own Osprey on there. So which one's the shop? Public gallery, bar, arrivals. Was it the ice cream shop or was it this? Oh. Oh wow, look at that. Even that's rotating. Hold on, I'll try and get a groovy screenshot. I'll have to move this down a little bit. I'll try and get the train in it as well, and the ice cream shop. There we go. Now we're talking. That model's in the shop on the left. Profly. Smart charger stuff. Security. Oh, this is check-in. Look at this. Big South African Airways check-in here. Through to departure, so we can actually follow the flow of people. Sorry about the zooming, folks, and the working around. There we are. Kenya Airways 783 back to Nairobi, which is the return flight from here going back, is on the board. How good is that? And the departure lounge. Jack lives here, apparently. all the shops open and close if you flip the time. Is that including these ones? Here we go. Oh, look at this! The little trolley's going in. That's a nice little touch. Up the top as well, did you see the lift open then, folks? Go back to we'll go to live time, 18:41 hours, the shop back open. And the other side as well, oops. Oh, this one's opening too. Kingston Controller, no worries buddy, thank you very much for the ATC, it's very much appreciated. Really appreciated. Yeah, that lift's animated. Got this cool little souvenir shop there. That's meant to be a water mask that's meant to be in the water. Hey, got little giraffes. Lots of giraffes. And little zebra models. There's that screenshot that we saw from before. And that clock, if we just flick the time, let's just have a little look here. Time. Woohee! Awesome. So that clock actually follows the time as well. Now, it's only one or two little things, 61 Tree Studio. I think it's overwhelmingly very, very nice indeed. Where's that lift? It's one of them. Because I'm sure it opened a minute ago. Unless I'm going mad. We've got to see arrivals yet as well. Passenger screen, passenger holding, lounge and departure. There it is. Quick, let's get in it. Oh! Too far. And through the door. We're on the second floor. I don't think I've ever been able to do that in a scenery until now. That's really nice, isn't it? Look at that. For 13 quid. And even the air conditioning units are actually rotating, look folks. How brilliant is that? There's the departures lounge. Apron textures are really nice. I think this is going to be baggage reclaim. Potentially. No. Just trying to find my way around here. Okay, so that's the cafe thing that we saw a minute ago. Aha. Now we're talking. Here's baggage reclaim. So this is actually animated and the belt is rotating. How brilliant is this? Nice little touches. It's all in the detail. And then to the arrivals hall. We can follow that through. Dosh. And it even got loads of little bags moving through for all these arrivals that we've just had arrive here at Livingstone Airport. Kingston Controller, big thank you to your ATC, by the way. Really appreciate that. So, sorry about that, had some internet connection issues. Huge cold front passing through the island right now, so it's affecting everything. With that said, thanks for flying out and see you next time. Big thank you for spending a bit of time with us today. Gave me some air traffic control. Have we got another suitcase going in? Yes, there we go. Yeah, it's actually affecting the rubber things. That's well good. So through the arrivals gate. Oh, look at this. Big old elephant, big lion. They're those pictures that we saw online. There's the zebra and a big old giraffe. Rhino. What have we got? Security. Ta-da! Back out to the apron. Got to get a screenshot with everyone. Very nice little bit of scenery here. In the middle of... actually, not even in the middle of. It's the southern tip of Zambia. Look at that. With a remarkable sunset. Where's that other aeroplane? It's over here, isn't it? Try and get a bit of a cool picture if I can, with everybody parked up. Yoink. The bathrooms are modelled as well in case we have to go. 61 Tree Studio says. Alright, let's have a quick look at those. Because I feel it'd be quite cool if they flush. In a strange way. What's in there? Oh wow, an actual church. Right, got to find the toilets. They were in here, weren't they? I guess I feel like I've learnt the layout already. This is fantastic. So you can't like click a little button there and make the hand dryer go off, but yeah, it's pretty cool, isn't it? What do you guys think? For freeware, a payware airport scenery. So we departed a really nice freeware Nairobi International Airport, and now, look at that. A really nice payware airport scenery for Zambia. And we, Harry Mwanga Kumbula International Airport here in Livingstone, Zambia. Big thanks to the developer, 61 Tree Studio, for sending us a copy. Hopefully you're really proud of actually what you've done. This is a really nice bit of scenery. It's available on Sim Market. It's linked in the description down below on the live stream. So if you want to go ahead and purchase it, then you know how to find it. It's just down, easy to click link in the description. Land Rover and a nice little Audi car over there as well positioned. But yeah, hit like before you head off. Thanks for flying along, everybody. I wonder if there's 61 trees, Doc. And it's their first ever payware airport scenery released. So this is pretty good. We're going to try and do a little bit more of Africa over the next few weeks. So we've flown here into Livingstone. I think we'll fly out of Livingstone to perhaps Windhoek. Maybe then Windhoek to St. Helena as well for another couple of live streams. Hit like before you head off. Hit subscribe if you've not done so already. Enjoy the rest of the week ahead. And big thank you to our air traffic control, as always, and our fellow pilots for joining in too. In the meantime, as always, thanks for watching, folks. And I'll see you very soon. Take care. Thanks for watching.